like I'm good, because the minute I say that, they're going to
do that.
Oh, but yeah, they're real people.
Oh, there we are.
Hello.
Okay.
Wouldn't you know it? Wouldn't you know it?
For all the blessings that you bestow upon each one of us here in this room and in this community, in this wonderful community. And we ask that you look over and guide those who are in control and power and help all of us to make good, just, and right decisions for all the citizens of this county. We ask these things all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
At this time, as we start the meeting at 2:02, Commissioner Brian Towns, Commissioner Todd Levent, is temporarily absent. Item 3, on to the agenda. Are there any changes to the agenda? Commissioners, do you know of anyone? See, Ms. Phil, I think we're going to
delay
item 4.
Yes. We can put that to the next agenda, the next work session. Would that be okay?
Let's put it on April 9th.
April 9th? Okay. That'd be good. I make a motion.
Second. This time, Commissioner Tam is present. 2:03. Motion to move item 4 to April 9th work session. Have a motion and second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed. Motion carries 4-0. Commissioner Bent, temporarily absent. Mr. Pop, I think there's one that you wanted on there, the resolution. I think it's a mute point right now.
Yes, sir.
Can we delete that?
Certainly can. Thank you for trying to find or finding out and figuring out, saying that, that they're already past its ripeness. So, yes. But
the motion to remove from the agenda.
I'd make the motion to remove item 17 from the agenda.
Second. We have a motion and a second to remove item 17 from the agenda. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? 4-0. Commissioner Levin still out. Doug, our counsel.
I have one to add, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. I have handed out in front of you all, and I think you should see a document called the Notification of Consent to Return of Compensation. This involves a appointments to be a deputy coroner involving Stan Rutledge. And I need to walk you through what this is about, what it means, why it's on here, and I would ask that be added as the last item on this work session. That will require a unanimous vote, since there's only four of you.
That's item 19 to be added. Do I have a motion?
I make a motion to add this as item 19 to the notification of consent.
Have a motion, second. Please vote. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? 4-0. Is that good enough, Counselor?
It is, sir. Thank you.
Commissioner Levin still absent. Any other changes at this time? Is there a motion to adopt the agenda as amended?
So moved.
Second.
Have a motion and a second to adopt the agenda. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And opposed? 4-0. Levin. Item 4. Presentation regarding proposed relocation of Safe House, the community center for Kern County owned site on Veterans Memorial. Judge Jackson is going to present this.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate the board allowing us the opportunity to make this presentation and present this request here today. Before you, with me today are Ashley Anderson, who's the executive director of SAP. She's seated directly to my left, and also Stephanie Lopez Howard, who is with the Criminal Justice Coordinating Council, which is the state agency through which federal funds are flowing that we hope to be able to implement and use, and that's part of the request that we have today for requesting a change in location for our facility. I'd like to thank county staff also for working with us in preparation of making this presentation, in particular Mr. Doug Darrow, the county manager, who met with us several times and provided very valuable feedback and guidance in this process, and also David Thornton, public facilities manager, who provided invaluable assistance in evaluating the new site that we are proposing and all facilities related questions with regard to that new site. As this board knows, you have supported SAFT in its mission, particularly the SAFT Family Visitation and Community Center in the past, by donating the use of property and a facility, a house that was renovated by SAFT with a lot of community support and input and resources brought to bear. And the site is currently located on county property next to Citizens Bank on a large tract of land on Veterans Memorial Boulevard. The SAFT Family Visitation and Community Center is located on the very front right-hand portion of that larger tract of land. And as we know, it's sitting on fairly valuable road front property there on Veterans Memorial Boulevard. And at some point, we will not be able to probably continue to use that site because it will be used for other things, the business development purposes that the rest of the property is basically slated for. And as I said, it is valuable sitting right on the road there. So in anticipation that at some point we're probably gonna have to move the SAFT Family Visitation and Community Center, and because we really are out of space in that current location, as nice as it is, and as much as it has provided for the community, the juvenile court, and the families and children that we serve. We really do need more space, and if we're going to implement the new federal grant, Safe Havens grant that I mentioned, the current facility just does not meet the needs or requirements of that grant. But to give you an idea of the impact that SAFT Family Visitation and Community Center has had on the community in the past couple of years, I believe we went into existence and started serving the community and the juvenile court in approximately June of 2010. In 2011, SAFT served 55 families through our supervised visitation program. And of course, you understand what that is when children are removed by the juvenile court from their homes because they have been either abused or neglected by their guardians. Then our goal is to restore that family once it is safe for those children to be restored in the home, to work on the problems that caused their removal, to hopefully repair those problems, and to ultimately restore those families together in a much stronger state than when the children were removed. And the goals of the juvenile court, as mandated by the legislature, set forth that is the mission of the juvenile court, to restore families, to protect children, keep them safe in the interim. And SAFT does provide and play a vital role in all of those legally mandated requirements of the juvenile court. And in order to keep families connected, you have to provide some sort of visitation. When a child is removed from their home, is placed in foster care or in other placements, you need to still keep that family connected and bonded through meaningful contact between the family members. And the supervised visitation program at SAFT does that in a very family-like, very nice environment for the children and the parents. And in 2011, we were able to serve 55 families in the SAFT supervised visitation program. In 2012, we served 75 families through the supervised visitation program. And during the course of serving those 75 families, we conducted approximately 1,300 supervised visitations and parenting classes in 2012. That's another key element of the services that SAFT provides. Again, when children are removed from their homes, usually poor parenting is one of the major issues that cause that removal and one of the main things that we need to address to fix the issues in the home. So allowing a safe, appropriate place where those visitations can occur between family and children also allows the monitor to observe some of the deficits in the interactions and the parenting skills of the parent, and to coach that parent firsthand as the visit is going on, before the visit, after the visit, take information learned from the last visit, coach the parent before the next visit occurs, and then following the visit in kind of a debriefing, as well as to engage and target areas in general where that parent needs to work on their skills through other parenting classes. So it's a holistic environment where a lot of things can be accomplished. So if we've taken the traumatic step of removing a child or children from their home, disrupting that family completely, when we do reunify that family, it can be done so they're a better situation for the children, parents, and hopefully so you never, the person having to make the decision about removing the family, namely me, never has to make that decision with regard to that family again. There's one large room at the current facility with a two-way mirror that allows you to monitor visits that are ongoing without being too intrusive. There are two smaller rooms without that same two-way mirror, very small rooms where you can also conduct visits, not as nice as the large room, obviously. But another key component is we want parents to show their responsibility and their desire to reunify with their kids by making all their visits. And obviously evening times and weekend times are at a premium. in order for parents to both work, because that's another requirement we place upon parents. You must maintain and hold down a job, show that you're able to support yourself and your children when they return to you. But we also say visit your children. So if they visit their children during normal working hours, there's an automatic conflict. So one thing that staff can provide is times when that conflict doesn't exist in the evening, you know, weekends. But obviously those times are a premium when you only have one or two or three rooms at most. So basically, I'm making referrals to staff now. People are saying, I need this weekend time or I need this evening time. They're all full. We don't have enough space in our current location. So that does limit our options and limit the ability of the court to move on with his business of reunifying these families and gathering the information necessary to do that. Or making the decision that these families can't be reunified and moving in a different direction as well. All that information can be gathered at SAP. The other component here, as I said, is we have received the Safe Havens grant from the Office of Violence Against Women. And again, the grant requirements, site requirements are not possible to meet at our current location. Tell you a little bit about the Safe Haven Supervised Visitation and Safe Exchange grant program. It provides an opportunity for communities to support the supervised visitation and safe exchange of children in situations involving domestic violence, dating violence, child abuse, sexual assault, or stalking. Studies have shown that the risk of violence is often greater for victims of domestic violence and their children after separation from an abusive situation. Even after separation, abusers, batterers often use visitation and exchange of children as an opportunity to inflict additional emotional, physical, and or other psychological abuse on victims and their children. This program, if implemented, provides supervised visitation and safe exchange of children by and between parents in situations involving domestic violence, dating violence, child abuse, sexual assault, or stalking. It protects children from the trauma of witnessing domestic or dating violence or experiencing abduction, injury, or death during parent and child visitation exchanges. And domestic violence committed between parents in front of children is defined by the legislature as child abuse. And that makes out the crime of cruelty to children. So this falls right in the wheelhouse of what we deal with in protecting children from child abuse, because we need to protect them from being witnesses and victims of domestic violence by either witnessing it between their parents or other adults who are responsible for them. Of course, we have a lot of juvenile court cases as well as a lot of superior court cases, as you know, that involve these kind of issues. This program would allow us to expand out of the juvenile realm into the superior court realm as well. And we can work from a prevention standpoint, so those children that are in superior court cases with domestic violence involved, whether it be divorce or other straight domestic violence cases, criminal cases, we can hopefully, through this program, prevent those children from being referred to the Department of Family and Children's Services or to the juvenile court because of that abuse or neglect by preventing it from happening altogether through this program. This project through this grant also protects parents and caretakers who are victims of domestic and dating violence from experiencing further violence, abuse, and threats during child visitation exchanges. And it protects children from the trauma of experiencing assault, physical, sexual, or other forms of assault or abuse during parent and child visitation and visitation exchanges. The site requirements that I'm talking about include there being two separate entrances into the facility where these safe exchanges or supervised visitations are going to occur. One entrance for the offender and one entrance for the victim. So you're again reducing the chances that they'll meet or have a chance to engage and any further domestic violence towards one another in the presence of the children or between themselves. It requires two entrances into the facility. Obviously, our current facility does not have two entrances. It has one entrance only. two entrances into the facility. Our current facility has one very, very narrow driveway with very little parking. So we don't have two entrances at our current facility. We need two parking lots in order to, one for the offender, one for the victim again. So again, we reduce the possibilities. They come into contact with one another. Our current facility has, as I said, one very, very small parking lot where that is not possible. And it requires separation of the parties during the times that they are on the premises together, all together. Our current facility makes that very difficult. So we have located another site. It's been checked out by our own public facilities department, and Mr. Thornton, as I indicated, given us a lot of advice and feedback. This property is much larger. It is over 9,000 square feet. It's located on Castleberry Road, right across from the Cumming Police Department, on the same side of the road where the fairgrounds are located, kind of in front of Tyson's, the old brick works building, I think, was there. But it's amazing how well this building is set up for our purposes. The two entrances on both sides, with two entrances, many different entrances really, but enough to meet all of our requirements, and has many other attributes that would allow us to have more visits, many more rooms available for visits for the juvenile program, all the separation required for the Safe Havens program. So there's a lot to recommend this building, and we've been able to negotiate a lease price for over 9,000 square feet of only $1,500 per month. A two-year guaranteed lease. And there is some reimbursement available from this federal grant to help offset the rent costs. We don't know exactly how much, but I have estimated it probably would be on the outside of the maximum, probably around $500 a month, but very likely it could be less than that. But there is some grant funding reimbursement available through the Safe Havens program. Of course, we have no reimbursement available for the juvenile part of the program, which we're not paying any rent now because the county's provided us with the facility that we're in. So if we move, we have that rent cost, and we're asking the county to help us pay that rent cost by funding the $1,500 per month in rent. You might ask, well, what's going to happen at the end of your two-year guaranteed lease? Well, hopefully, the county will consider potentially purchasing this property because it could have a lot of uses, including ours, going forward into the future, or SAF will be able to secure the necessary financing from other sources to be able to purchase the property, ideally for itself.
If we were going to consider purchasing it, would it be better to enter into a lease purchase now with them instead of throwing away that money for 2 years and then purchase?
Actually, I addressed that with the owner, and he said that the $1,500 a month covers his insurance, and there's no upside to that $1,500. So he said there would be no point in doing a lease purchase. There's no money that could go towards the purchase of the building.
They're not requiring a triple net lease thing. They're covering all the maintenance. Is that what you're saying? That's why he does this.
I mean, Commissioner, prevent a ride at 219.
I agree to the point. Have they discussed with themselves? Sometimes people in this market believe in 2 years from now that the value of any property is much greater than they're trying to get to that day. Will they give you a first option right guaranteed price today for what that price would be in 2 years?
He did not state that. He said the price today is $695 and includes brokerage fees, and he is anticipating it being more valuable with the core improvements in downtown in a couple of years. So he did give us 2 years, a third year option at the same rent price, and then from there we would have to negotiate if he didn't sell it.
The rent is very good.
Yeah, it's very,
very generous.
Not as good as zero.
Right.
But I'm just curious if you would take a moment to ask him what he would do for a first right purchase with your same retinol. So at least you have a price set for 2 years that won't be a gamble or a risk to what it might be at that time. You have some idea of what it might be if you choose to take that first option to purchase.
I'm sure he's going to build in some incentives if he's going to put it 3 years out. I mean, do we want to buy this type of building 3 years from now?
I don't know, but it's nice to have the option. You can always walk away with that penalty, or you can take it if you want to.
Yeah.
You can build your own. But at least you have that option, and if it's better dollar for dollar to build your own, you can make a better decision.
How old is the building?
In the 1990s.
It's
for George Reed. It has a brand new roof.
I can't believe that we see the property they were on as so unbelievably valuable that we can, you know, help them just develop something there. Costing us nothing.
What, the property on that? But what we got, we have to incorporate that property maybe worth more than having a cash flow that we can have plans for.
Everybody keeps talking about we could.
Judge, you talked about maybe a different entrance. Did I hear that correctly?
Yes. Mind?
How much in renovations do you think the building could be? Dollar-wise.
It's a big current facility.
You said up to $12,000, which was going to be covered by...
At the future site that we want to go to, but not at the current. Not at the current location. Current location, were you asking about current or the future?
I was.
The current. The renovations that we did when we first took over the property was valued at around $70,000 that we put into it. A lot of it was donated. I don't have an exact estimate, but the discussions that we've had would be around the same, because we'd have to put in another entrance, another parking lot. We'd have to build out additional rooms.
It's too small without spending a lot of money on to expand.
Absolutely. We'd have to add several more rooms.
I'm just trying.
Additional entrances.
Yeah, I understand this is y'all's best option. I've looked around and have to rely on y'all's opinion. Y'all know your business.
The county staff has also assisted us in that process.
Exactly. I know a little, and Ms. Mills knows a little bit of the real estate market, so the numbers get landed, we kind of understand about where the value is or not. How many acres on that land that would be included?
1.5 to 2 acres.
Actually, 1.3.
On the new facility? Yes. The new facility.
Judge Jackson and I talked about this in relation to the governor, you know, is changing. The juvenile justice bill is in right now, and the county is going to be, it's going to be placed in our lap to take care of juvenile justice within our counties, sending out a lot fewer and developing our own programs. And he believes that this will tie in the preventative portion of meeting the needs of what's fixing to be dropped in our lap too, so it does serve a twofold.
Is this building certainly?
No.
Well,
the size of the building could also provide us additional opportunities to meet these other mandates that are coming down the pipe. House Bill 242, I believe it is, was passed by the House, the Juvenile Justice Reform Act, includes these new mandates on the juvenile justice reform side. So everyone fully expects this bill will be passed by the legislature this year. Let's go for the Senate.
We give you additional funds last year, actually. The county.
Oh, through the social services grant, yes.
How much was that?
Last year or this year?
This year.
This year, 15. The first year was 10, the second year was 11, and this year was 15.
Which is 10. I mean, are they wanting that on top of the grant?
Oh, yeah.
That's what I mean. So it's 15 plus to.
Yeah, that funding helps to improve some operational things within the program, like higher security equipment, some operational costs, things like that. So this would be separate.
because of the size of the building, we, of course, our utilities will be quite a bit more than they are now in the present building. We're estimating $1,000 per month. So we'll have higher upkeep costs in this facility as well. So we'll still be seeking all of our other sources of funding to plus upping those to probably help us maintain this larger space as well.
Two things that might help you with this, just a little historical data. You probably recall this, and it's in your books, April 24, 2012. The board directed me and other staff, get with Judge Jackson and his staff, to look at and discuss options for a long-term solution. I don't want you to think that he just showed up here today just asking for money. This was actually a directive from the board. And since that time, we've been working on this, and that's why he's here today. As far as funding, if you go to your agenda request, you've probably already seen this, but what we're talking about, in addition to any money that's funded through social services in that grant, you're looking at approximately seven months worth of rent, if you were a lease for 2013. You'd be looking at $10,500 for 2013, $18,000 for 2014, and then $7,500 for 2015. And that would be less any grant reimbursement. So if you wanted to kind of break it down with regard to the amount of funding that we're requesting today for 13 and for 14 and the remainder for 15, those are the numbers you'd be looking at today. Just want to draw your attention to those. 2015 would take you through the 3 years. Thank you.
So the end of, so the implementation, we've been in a year planning phase for the federal grant, and then the implementation phase is 2 years. And then we can apply for continuation funding, which would allow us an additional 3 years if granted. So the program could go short term or 5 years. And we also talked about at our current facility, we could put another nonprofit in that space that is currently paying rent, that would reduce their rent, and we could use that money to offset this funding to where we would be going.
Put another nonprofit in the building
for the remainder of
the current building,
like a Mentor Me or another nonprofit organization.
Can we allow them to rent that building, Ken?
Well, just keep in mind with respect to all this discussion that we're going to have to link it back, as we have done. Remember with the Social Services Committee, how we've linked it back by way of documentation to things that the county can legitimately fund. And so I'm kind of trying to get a synthesis of where the policy is going, then I'll work with Judge Jackson and staff to make sure that it fits. So the answer is, can they sublease it out? I'd want to see where the direction I get from the board goes a little bit more
obviously, they have more control over that if they own the building.
Right, and if it's with an entity that we're otherwise funding, there's a Social Services Committee, then I've already done that analysis, and I've already concluded that we can legitimately fund those. So.
Bethany is one of those.
Right. I have a couple of points. I just divided the $9,000 by the square, the dollar figure at 77.2 dollars per square foot. And 1.3 acres is pretty much not an excessive amount of land for that kind of a building. So I'm not going to add any more for the land. This is just my experience, and that's not in stone because of appraisal. Last Thursday, I spent the afternoon with a gentleman by the name of John Adams. I think you got that morning, pastor at Ryan Community Church. And I understand that he was trying to pull together other churches to help you as well, trying to pull together help the community. Right. Do you see that being an asset to help offset some of this, or is that for different purposes?
It could help the purposes for the visitation center, because what John Adams is trying to assist us with is remedying the extreme lack of placement resources, foster parents, that we have available in Forsyth County right now. It's more difficult to make use of the SAF center without children being placed locally, and to really accomplish all those things that I was talking about previously towards reunification. If you've got kids, you know, in Augusta, we've got some of our kids in Augusta now, you know,
Bacon, all over the state. So it all, as I was telling Commissioner Mills when I said it, all links together in one way or the other. So, yes, this, you know, that's part of the SAF's mission is to recruit and support foster parents as well. So yeah. Certainly this facility would be a base for those kinds of efforts.
We would be able to store our resource closet there like we do at our current facility. So when children enter foster care and they come with a trash bag, we provide them with the immediate necessities, luggage, clothing, car seats, furniture, cribs. We also would be able to conduct our monthly support group meetings at the space. We'd be able to do our monthly parent night out for the children in foster and adoptive care. All the programs that we do in addition to the visitation center program.
Y'all might want to use this as a good time for calling all churches to step up and help at this moment. It seems like several of them are coming forward now and it was a great opportunity.
Definitely.
Well, and
in terms of remodeling and so forth, new facility in particular, that's where we'll be looking for help to.
Sure. Oh yeah, and with this whole new program, I mean, it's all falling in our laps to create our own.
Under House Bill 242. Do y'all know of any other facility county that may become available in a couple of years if they lease this, they won't something already have, or should we consider, if they're asking $695, do we consider making offers more interwined if their appraisal say it's worth in today's world?
That building's too old. I would think we'd be better off to look at some land. We got land at the tax center over on 306, all we got land at the bank. But I think rent is a great deal at $1,500.
It is, I agree.
And I don't see any reason you can't enter into that rent. I would be for it. But I would also like to not look at building future buildings some way with funds from the state or grant money or fund money. We have that state program that one thing we never used it, Doug, the Public Facilities Authority that can build buildings through bonds. We have that we can look at. But we have land. I don't want to spend that kind of money for a 10 or 15 year old building and watch completely remodeled. Only 1 acre of land.
The air conditioning, or HVAC, it's got a question of the $10,000 possible cost.
That was just an estimation between myself and Mr. Thornton, and that's specific to the warehouse that we could utilize for a joint partnership with Superior Court, maybe drug testing lab, or we could use it as a larger activity space for kids to
visit. But you're
going to
take care of her.
Yeah.
You won't be coming back to us asking.
No. And I put the modifications and the utility costs just so the county can see that the organization does have stake in the program, and
we've got skin in this game.
Absolutely. And that property, because of its location to the fairgrounds, we can utilize the parking lot as a fundraiser for all of the fairground events. The owner's letting us do a fundraiser on the 30th of March for Taste of Forsyth, and with us having the building, so we would be raising money and trying to build up a net so that we can put towards our operations, you know, anything that we need for the program and also for future assistance with securing a permanent location.
Can Council, if we have a consensus of the board kind of about taking a vote on, could we authorize you to work with them to see if they can rent the house out to bring in additional funds?
That's absolutely. We can do that. We can look at that issue. Have you thought, does the board want to give any direction regarding the notion of just the lease, and would we want to be the actual tenant and then sublease to SAFT, which would be my preference. But anyway, just
which you feel saves us money and protects us.
Well, I'd like
that's liability on us. If we just gave them and they let them lease themselves, would that put a liability on them?
I feel like we're probably liable anyway if we're paying the rent. And I think it would give us more control, a little bit more control, at least over making sure that the rent provisions are honored and things of that nature. Not suggesting anything wouldn't be, but it just would make me feel more comfortable.
Gotcha. Y'all feel comfortable with this? Y'all mind Ken going forward?
No, you'll have a motion when you approve all this. So right now, all you're giving me is direction.
Can we add one more thing? If we're going to do the two-year lease, should we also give direction that we don't start now to try to contribute away the building? At least I'd look into that. Does that ever have a sense by the time the two-year lease is up? now would be the time to get the direction. We start looking at what the options might be.
We've got the 2-year lease and an option.
An option for 30 years.
Same cost. Saying, we're slow.
Let's do this first and we come back to the other one.
But don't forget about it because we'll never have it done in time to get here.
And our time frame to implement this program is the beginning of June. We're planning to submit. We've been working on all of our policies and procedures and our site plans, and we're also looking to open up a satellite office in Dawsonville at the same time. So we're working with that county and our agent in that side as well. But we are looking to submit everything as a package at the beginning of April, maybe the mid-April.
That would include the site here so that the Office of Violence Against Women has got to review our proposed site and tell us and make sure that it is. Meets all the criteria.
Can you get with our attorney, county attorney, and work all this out and bring it back to us?
We will do that. Judge Jackson and I have been able to work through a lot of this before, so I'm not the least bit concerned about it.
I heard you mention something about mentors, whatever that was.
The program that we had thought of as being a good potential tenant for the current location on Veterans Memorial Boulevard, if we went that route, once we moved out, was Mentor Me, North Georgia. And I indicated, Mr. Gerard said that if they were already receiving funds on the Social Services Committee. He's already done the analysis, indicate that that is an organization county can fund. And I said Mentor Me is an organization that has already been funded through the Social Services Committee. So, in effect, Ken's already done that analysis and determined that they are an appropriate organization for the county to help support the funding.
The two things, one is, were they interested in this building? Two, if it goes that way, everybody should know that it's highly improbable that that adds revenue, which can be then brought over to this new building, because they would want similar to what we've got now, I would expect.
Well, the idea would be is they're paying rent $1,000, $1,200, $1,500 a month now. So if we offered them this building at $500 a month, then they're getting a big break on rent from what they're paying now, but the county's also getting a little bit of an income stream to offset the $1,500 a month the rent cost was our thinking on the iron building.
So. Probably does to subsidize. Well, there's possibilities out there.
But also, let's say they don't take it, we're allowed, it's our building at that point, y'all leave, and we can rent it to anybody we want to for any amount of money we want to, correct?
Right, yeah, we could rent it just in the world of commerce. You know, right. The only trick here has been is that I think SAFT is getting it for, I think, $10 a year or something, so it's
correct,
it's,
so we could offset income, should we do it to the private?
That can't work good, so. Any other questions about this?
We'll get with the judge.
Okay. Sure. Thank you.
Sounds good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
We appreciate your time.
Item 2, the establishment of a 2013 local supplement for the South County Solicitor as appointed by Governor Deal. Director of Law Enforcement.
Yes, Commissioners. On March 6th, Governor Deal appointed Attorney Donna Gopal to fill the Solicitor General vacancy in Forsyth County. The Solicitor General position compensation is comprised of a base salary and also a local supplement. The base salary is set by local legislation to be 75% of the state court judge's compensation. That is set then for 2013 as $103,492 for base compensation. The supplement by the county has been budgeted for 2013 to be $19,941. And that is the item for discussion for the Board of Commissioners to determine.
Sorry, where did the $19,000 come from?
That actually, a local supplement began back when the solicitor began in office. Leslie Abernathy had been solicitor for 16 years, from 1997 through January the 10th, 2013. In the local supplement, the purpose of that is to add additional compensation for type of competitive, type of total compensation.
We've been doing this, how many years have we been doing this supplement?
Really since around 1998, I believe.
About the same every year, 19,000?
No, it increased as time went by. Leslie Abernathy has been solicitor for 16 years. So the supplements are typically set as a an amount and then increased as COLAs are applied.
When they interviewed for this position, did they present it as $124,433 job, or did they include the supplement in the interview?
I was not part of those interviews, so I have no idea. With the total supplement, that the total amount would be $123,433. Donna Gopal had served as assistant solicitor for about three and a half years with Forsyth County from June of 2008 through December of 2011. If that helps any for your consideration.
David, do we have this in the budget every year? Is this something we budget
about?
Yes,
it's in the budget when it's known going in, and it's the numbers you give us in the budget.
If this is the amount that Leslie Abernathy was receiving after all those years of service, is it correct to give that same amount of money to somebody new to the position?
That's totally at the discretion of the board.
But she's there for a lot of years to earn it up to that level. So I'll let your question say much.
Pat, does this fall into one of those supplements too that if you give it, the board has to retain it through the term? Is this along the same lines of that?
Yes.
You know what I'm talking about? Like, if you give a supplement to, in many instances in Georgia law, if you give any sort of a supplement to an elected official like a judge, you can't reduce it during the term. You know, the monkey business that could be occasioned.
Term of the judge.
I'm just using the judge as an example.
Yes.
But I was asking, Pat, is this the same? I just wasn't sure off the top of my head if this falls into the same category of once you give it, it goes for the full term, and y'all could revisit it again after, 4 years, I suppose.
Not every year in the budget.
Right.
So basically, we obligated to give the $19,400.
No.
I'm just saying, once you make your decision,
you can either issue no supplement or a portion of it or the whole thing. That's totally at your discretion.
You can do a portion each year when you give the increase, just as anybody would in any position.
I'm forgiving Liz, but I hate it if it's been presented to her that we're giving her.
How do we find out?
I don't know.
In other words, what was her expectation?
Right.
Yes.
How were we presented as doing something that wasn't brought to our attention?
Well, the governor is the one that.
No, the supplement.
Appointed her, though. Okay.
When is she up for election? When is Donna Gopal?
Almost 4 years because Leslie was just.
What did she?
Yes.
Started the cycle.
Yes.
Okay. For her.
Yes. So she would serve the rest of the term. So it'd be 3 years, 11 months.
10 months.
That's a great question that you presented as part of a package.
Is it wrong to ask them to find out those problems? Is there time for that?
Or you could offer an amount and you'll find out.
I'm sure you will.
Yeah. I'm trying to keep that.
It's hard to go down and keep good solicitors if she's already accepted the job. But I feel like that's a question to be answered.
I do like to. I mean, I agree with you in the fact that Leslie had been in the job for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
Did that supplement increase with the Appanathy over the years?
Yes, it did.
You know what I'm saying? So it doesn't seem fair to give it to them personally.
I did include just a list of other supplements for other local officials that the board gives. Some do not get any local supplements, some do get local supplements.
I can mention one group of elected officials that don't get supplements. We're commissioners.
Well, yes. We're elected that way, y'all.
That's correct.
That's right.
So what were you on?
Let's get on with that. This here.
All right, what do you want to, you want to do it as an increase every year? You want to do it?
If you establish it now, it's got to stay four years.
No,
it would go up.
Down.
What I would recommend.
It just can't go down.
No, it can't go down. But what I would recommend that any increases be tied to the COLAs.
Or caseload.
And that's how the increases are applied to all other supplements. Is that if a COLA is applied elsewhere in the county, then the supplements also are increased.
That seems fair. So where's the government?
Mm-hmm. She served for 16 years.
That's correct.
But I still think it, we need to, I mean, I think it'd be unfair if we just took it away and she wasn't offered it.
But we don't know. I think 10 is fair to structure.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
That's
the governor.
Dagger, motion.
Me too. Make a motion for the 2013 supplement to the new Forsyth County Solicitor, an amount of $10,000 from the county.
So is that then to be reviewed in 12 months or
4 years? Does it go up with the COLA automatically or not?
Not on that motion.
Why don't you make it go up with the COLA?
I thought the salary went up with the COLA.
The base salary is tied to the state court judge's compensation. It's 75% of that. So if the state court judge's salaries went up, then so would the solicitors.
So we could just say on our $10,000 that we would review annually.
Well, are you going to... The board typically does not review everybody's salary.
But you can let it go up with the salary as it goes up.
Yeah.
The state. It sounds reasonable. That's how Leslie finally got heard up where it was. It didn't start at that.
We tie it to our local COLA increases.
There you go.
Okay. If we do.
Go ahead. If you, in your motion, you tie it to our local COLAs, that'll be a challenge. In fact, the last couple of years we've increased or provided a COLA for the employees. Next year you'll hear in the Finance Committee our recommendation would be if there is an increase for employees in 2014, it will be merit increase as opposed to a COLA. So if there's not a guarantee, there'll be a COLA increase every year.
Could you just based on the salary increases from the county?
I'm sorry?
Based on salary increases that come with the county?
Which is not all.
No, merit is totally separate than the COLA, but the board...
Don't base it on COLA.
Keep it as a fixed percentage of the salary, whatever it is now. So it's around 18 or 19% of the salary. To say that it shall remain 18, 19% of the salary.
We have to get some.
Salary goes up, so does
correct.
This.
We're setting now a supplement based on percentage of salaries.
Well,
we never revisit any other supplements every year.
You just can't lower it.
So I don't
get
Can I suggest if just because a merit is being off, let's say next year we go with a merit, the board certainly has the opportunity to say, well, for local supplements, we wish to apply the same amount or less or a portion of that to be applied towards supplements. And that way, when we're building the budget, we would know, okay, local supplements would have, let's say, 3% or 2%, I don't know.
In the same way we treat other
supplements. We're just going to review it
annually. Yes, all supplements.
Yeah, treating the same way as other supplements.
It should be treated the same as other supplements.
We were just talking about how we didn't want to be tied to something or make the motion where it would be so restrictive, you know.
Are you going to restate your motion, Cindy?
Can I?
Yes.
Before you do that, though, with respect to reviewing it annually, do you all really want to be in the position,
no,
though, of reviewing? Because it almost looks like you're assessing performance, is my,
yeah,
only fear.
Are we 10,000 and look at it in 4 years?
Throw it at 10,000, make it a fixed percentage, and look at it in 4 years.
Motion was
okay,
to sum it at 10,000 for the
if
county.
The person receiving that, though, doesn't think that's fair, then they're going to have to put it back on the agenda for us to review it.
And that's different than us.
That's different. Do that,
you could just look at it in 12 months.
Well, we don't have to argue that part.
You didn't say that it had to be every 12 months. So you could look at it in 12 months.
All right, Reed, what was the motion?
The motion was 2013 supplement of $10,000.
Start this year.
Yeah. We just leave it at that?
No review. He had a second.
That's
we had a motion and a second.
I removed my second because I thought we were going to redo the motion. So I can put my second back in?
Yes.
Whatever.
Okay, I remember second.
Okay, you're right. We have a motion and a second for a supplement of $10,000 for the county for 2013. Everybody understand? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Passes 5-0.
Thank you.
Item 3, review, discussion, and mitigation bank of Tisdale, presented by CH2 Ben Hill.
Mr. Chairman, back in 2009, we had CH2 Ben Hill do a mitigation feasibility study on 53 county-owned properties. We were asked to update that. I have Chris and Tom and Kevin Middlebrooks here with CH2 and Hill to give you an update on their updated information they provided you in your technical memorandum, and they'll answer any questions when they're through with their presentation.
Thank you, John. Everybody say okay? I'm Chrissy Tom. I work with CH2 and Hill. Kevin and I both specialize in environmental permit compliance, so that includes mitigation banking for wetlands and streams. So as John said, back in 2009, we originally did a feasibility study on behalf of the county to look at market conditions and determine if there were any feasible locations and the cost effectiveness of potentially establishing a mitigation bank. So we've been asked to update, given the current market conditions, and things have changed since 2009, both in the world of mitigation and certainly in the development market, which can affect the availability of credits. So I've got about 10 slides I'm going to run through. Please stop me at any time and let me know what information you'd like me to provide you. I'm going to do a brief overview of what is mitigation banking, make sure everybody understands. Talk a little bit about what Forsyth County's average credit needs have been for the past few years in terms of construction projects, and then talk a little bit about the mitigation feasibility study that we just recently updated. What is mitigation banking? What we're talking about here is wetlands or streams that have been degraded, and efforts have been made to restore those in compliance with requirements of the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers.
What causes the degradation?
So, when in certain ecosystems, there's a certain level of just natural dynamics that happen in the ecosystem. So things, you know, if you look at a stream, things aren't always the same. There's pools and there's riffles and there's other features that contribute to the habitat and kind of the ecosystem diversity there. So over time, what can happen if there's stressors in the watershed, so in the areas that drain into that stream, there's the potential to basically change that dynamic. And the most common thing we see, particularly in areas where you have development, is there's an increase in impervious cover in the watershed, so there's more concrete, there's more asphalt, and that changes how stormwater and hydrology functions in that ecosystem. That can then lead to what's called downcutting and incising of the stream system, And we actually have a photo later in the presentation of Kevin standing in a variant size stream channel where he's up over his, it's up over his head. So that's generally what we think of when we think of degradation. It's really just the quality of the habitat to support a diverse ecological community is impacted or quality is impacted. So what we see here in terms of mitigation banking is that we know that we have an opportunity to restore some of these degraded ecosystems. We also know that there's other ecosystems that may be impacted by construction projects that have to occur for various purposes, just in terms of development. So the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers is responsible for administrating the Section 4 permitting process. It's part of the Clean Water Act, so it's really designed to basically address any impacts that have to occur to more sensitive ecosystems like wetlands and streams. And mitigation banking has been established to provide a mechanism to offset some of those impacts by restoring degraded wetlands and streams, potentially in other locations. So there's other choices for mitigation, but currently in the federal regulations, mitigation banking is the first choice to provide mitigation. So some of you may be aware that previously there were site-specific mitigation requirements. So if you impacted a wetland or a stream on a certain piece of land, you would then find a way to offset those impacts on the same site. That's not necessarily the first choice anymore. What the Corps is most focused on is finding these contiguous large-scale properties where kind of the whole watershed ecosystem can be improved and restored. So that's the focus here. So there's Kevin standing in an incised stream channel right here. And that's actually at Lanier Lands, up in the north part of the county. So when we think of degraded ecosystems, generally what we think of is an incised channel where you're just not, you're not supporting the same ecological community or water quality conditions that you would naturally expect. You can see on the left here, this is actually Midway Park in the county. This is the recent stream restoration project.
I'd like to touch on that one, Lanier Land. Here it is, and using that as your example, as your, I guess, extreme degraded area. But yet it's not a heavily developed area, it's rock.
Mm-hmm. So
it's not because of development.
What happens in a lot of cases, particularly here in the southeast, is agricultural practices have resulted in these. So Lanier Land's a good example where, you know, likely the stream was altered and moved over to part of the valley to increase potential farming opportunities. Not only that, but just having horses and cows out of pasture, that those livestock going in another creek wear down the banks. And that's honestly what we see a lot of the impacts, particularly in the metro area and the Piedmont. You know, agricultural land that was converted over to either residential or commercial uses still have that effect. And that's what's going on here. This is a smaller stream that feeds into Taylor Creek. And it's likely years ago when Taylor Creek was moved over to the side of the valley, those impacts just carried up this smaller tributary.
So in terms of looking at projects that may require mitigation, so focus more on a construction project that has to be permitted through the Corps of Engineers. Generally, these are the thresholds that the Corps looks for to require mitigation credits. So that's 100 linear feet of stream or a tenth of an acre of wetlands. So fairly low thresholds here. An example of a project for water and sewer in the last few years is Post Road Force Main. So I believe that project was about 17,000 linear feet. And there were 54 linear feet of stream crossing, of actual stream impact. So even though the project was 17,000 linear feet, the actual stream crossings that were impacted by that project were only on the order of 54 linear feet. So because it's 54 linear feet, that falls underneath that 100-foot threshold. The project still had to be permitted, but it didn't necessarily require a mitigation credit purchase. So that's just an example. But these construction projects for the county would fall into many different categories: roads, bridges, water and sewer lines might be the most common, buildings. So any chance to avoid these impacts is certainly encouraged, but in some cases, just by the nature of what these projects are, there are going to be impacts, and mitigation credits and mitigation banking is the way that those are offset. Now, this table was originally prepared back in 2009 as part of the original feasibility study. So I just want to use this as an opportunity to explain some of the differences that we're seeing in the mitigation market today as compared to a few years ago. So you see that these are just two county departments with an average number of credits that were purchased per year to offset construction impacts. So this was based on kind of the 2000 to probably 2007 timeframe of construction projects. So we've got about 7,500 credits between the two departments for stream credits, which are calculated separately from wetland credits, and there we have about 15 credits per year. So at the time, stream credits were worth about $100 per credit, and wetland credits were about $7,500 per credit. So today what we see is a shift. So at this time, the mitigation market was really developing. There were many private bankers entering the market, and there was a lot of demand for those credits just based on the economic development. Since that time, kind of the economic slowdown has happened, and there just haven't been as many construction projects in Metro Atlanta in general. So what we see is that there's actually a flux of supply. We've got a lot of stream credits available. We have more wetland credits available too, but maybe not quite as many as streams. But for stream credits, what we're seeing is that the market is saturated. So whereas credits used to go for $100 per credit, now they're going for $35 a credit or even $30 a credit. So that might give you an indication of where the market is headed in terms of feasibility and how we can do a cost-benefit analysis for county-owned properties in particular. Wetland credits were previously about $7,500 per credit. Now we're seeing prices as high as $25,000 per credit. So we certainly see that wetland credits have continued to increase in value compared to stream credits. But there are credits available, openly available on the market, which was not necessarily the case a few years ago. So the other thing I'll note is that the number of stream credits that the county is using on kind of an annual basis since the 2009 feasibility study has really changed. So what we're seeing is really more on the order of 100 to 500 stream credits per year and about one wetland credit per year. So that's kind of the average county use that we've seen over time. An example is the Lower Big Creek Pump Station for water and sewer, where I think this was in 2011, we purchased about one wetland credit to offset impacts, and the cost was a little over $17,000. We're going to shift to talking about feasibility of mitigation in Forsyth County now. Bottom line, I'm going to jump right to the bottom bullet here. So what we did was go out and look at county-owned properties and identify those properties that have degraded stream and wetland segments that could potentially be used for restoration and mitigation banking. So there's one we have in mind, and that's Lanier Land, and that's a typical county property. And we could expect to spend roughly $3 million to develop a mitigation bank. Now, just based on the current credit market values, we probably would earn about $2 million on the credit sale. So there's $1 million shortfall there. Now, keep in mind that for most municipal banks, this is different for private banks than it is for municipal banks. Most municipal banks don't aim to recoup the costs of their existing projects, and oftentimes they don't always intend to break even. It's just another revenue stream to support watershed improvements that may provide other values for the county. So here's a map that shows some of the locations that we determined were feasible. These are county-owned properties, Most of them are floodplain properties. There's a few there with green stars that are highly recommended projects. So this is just to show you just kind of an overview of the properties that were reviewed. We had about 55 or 57 properties ultimately that we looked at here. And just for reference, Lanier Land is right up here. So we've got just the first page of the memos that we've developed to evaluate feasibility on the left, and we can make those available to anybody who's interested in more information. They're pretty detailed. What we've chosen to pull out here is just the highly feasible mitigation sites. So we've got a handful of sites here just based on stream length and construction feasibility and kind of some other key aspects of a site that we would look at to determine if mitigation banking is even a possibility there, the primary one being, is there an opportunity to restore the ecosystem? You'll notice here that we only have stream length, and stream credits on here. The reason for that is because most of the county-owned properties that we reviewed don't necessarily have good opportunities to provide wetland enhancement and restoration. So you'll recall that that's where you see kind of the increasing market values on the wetland side, not the stream side. So keep that in mind. You'll also notice that a couple of these properties have since had some other funding opportunities. So Cheatham Creek at Midway Park, that project is actually in the ground. That project was funded with a 319 grant through EPA and EPD, 40-60 cost share. So there was another avenue to conduct watershed improvements for that particular location. Now, Big Creek at Fowler Park Complex and Fowler Water Treatment Plant has also been submitted to EPD and EPA for grant funding, potentially through that same 319 program. And we have not heard whether that project has been funded or not. Lanier Land is also on the list here, down at the bottom. So you can see we have 5,300 linear feet, and that's the project that Kevin had most recently reviewed. So that was kind of a good example for us of somewhere where you actually had a lot of room to do a full stream restoration and really kind of maximize the number of credits that you could generate, that being almost 61,000 credits, approximately 1.8 million generated. Now keep in mind, that's not a net value, that's just what would the credit cost be at the current market value. Don't try and read this, don't hurt your eyes. This is a timeline that we've developed to help visualize just all the milestones that are needed to actually get a mitigation bank permitted through the Corps of Engineers. So what we're looking at here is really almost a 10-year commitment from kind of start and site selection all the way through design and agency review and developing a banking instrument that's approved by the Corps of Engineers, conducting the design, developing a restrictive covenant to protect the property in perpetuity, construction, all the way through 7 years of monitoring to demonstrate success for the Corps of Engineers. So you can see we've got some values assigned there, but we're looking at $3 million is rough cost estimate for an average county-owned property like Lanier Land to establish a mitigation bank. So just keep in mind, the approval of a mitigation bank, just basically getting the bank through the Corps of Engineers, through that approval process, typically takes 1.5 to 3 years. So we're talking about not something that can be completed within a year.
And I know no one's jumping at the chance to lose $1 million to do it the way you described in that first or second slide, but if we had a mitigation bank, and if we had as we had earlier in the year, where we are having to pay for mitigation, right, and Ken, correct me if I'm not saying that right, of where we condemned property and we wound up having to pay for the mitigation rights of that property, if we had had credits, could we have negotiated with the credits instead of a dollar amount? Could we have said, well,
we have taken away so many of your credits, but we have that many credits back that we can give you.
In other words, are they a fungible commodity? Or literally, you could have just given some of ours to them and said, now you're even?
My understanding is that yes. I mean, they're transferable. Do you agree with that, Kevin?
They are transferable, but I think that
those credits.
My perspective on a very unique situation. Those credits haven't really been, they haven't been issued, they haven't been released by the Army Corps of Engineers yet. So if the Army Corps had said, okay, I don't remember the exact numbers, but here's 300,000 credits that are on the market, and then you condemned that property and said, these credits are no longer available, then yes, you could transfer them that way.
But in all likelihood, if people are looking to get money, they're not going to be interested in the credits. It's got to do with what they're really looking for, I guess.
And I believe what I'm seeing too is that we have opportunities for a lot of stream credits, but remember those were wetlands credits.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, those were mainly wetland credits on that property that were in consideration.
Yep.
Okay, so this is my summary slide. This is the last slide. So what we see is an improving economy. So we're seeing pickups in development. So right now the market is pretty saturated with stream credits and there are wetland credits available. So that could change. The mitigation credit market does change as we've really been able to observe since it really kind of started getting hot back in the early 2000s. So again, there's few opportunities on county-owned land. Now there's other opportunities within Forsyth County to potentially purchase a property to generate wetland credits, but what we're seeing on the county-owned land is that there's not that opportunity. So mitigation bank implementation tends to be more financially viable, so you can generate more credits kind of more efficiently the larger the site is. So that's just something to consider as a big picture item for a mitigation
bank. The wetland site or the stream site?
Either one.
Either one.
So you must have the Corps approval to establish a mitigation bank. That can be kind of a long process, just with the speed at which reviews happen. You can look at, needing to accommodate multiple years and making this a long-term project. So for most local municipal banks, a couple others locally being Gwinnett County and Clayton County, who do have municipal mitigation banks established, what they're looking to do is not necessarily provide a revenue stream. They're just looking to offset some of the costs of watershed improvements that can meet a number of other requirements and objectives of the county. So things like compliance with water, wastewater, stormwater permits, water quality protection, habitat improvement, providing an improvement in aesthetics, and community involvement education, so similar to the interpretive signage that's out at Midway Park, to basically provide an opportunity for passive recreation and involvement of the community. So that's all I had. I'd be happy to discuss or answer any questions you might have.
Any questions for board about this? So we'll be happy to, this is very informative, but today we'd have to make any motion to start a mitigation bank or just for information only today?
My understanding is maybe
for information only. It's up to the board if you want to take any action.
I guess the only other thing is I wouldn't expect that there's just gobs of funding out there from somebody else to straighten out your stream banks or your water.
Funding is pretty limited for this particular circumstance. I think the county has really benefited from the funding that is available, particularly through the 319 program.
I mean, is Lanier Land a good candidate for that 319 program to put in?
Lanier Land would be a good candidate. However, it would probably need to be done in phases. So the maximum cost share for 319 per year is $400,000, meaning that you'd be looking at a project size of about $666,000 total with the county cost share and the federal cost share. So the project could certainly be broken up into phases.
1 year project?
1 year,
$660,000.
Yeah, but the 319 program is designed to accommodate multi-phase projects, and actually that's something that gets scored higher when they review projects for funding through 319.
Let me ask you this, and this isn't about a specific place, although sort of, deer land, but if streams get messed up because something man has done, and you mitigate it and make it look like it should, I guess, for lack of a better word, and then turn right around and develop stuff all around that, and it tears it out again, it's a little bit counterproductive, which then leads me to believe, if you were to get credits through the Corps, will they then impose stuff on you regarding the surrounding streams so that that doesn't happen, or do they just say, no, we're just talking about this one stream?
So there's a couple things there. Number one, the Corps can't impose requirements on you that are outside of the area that's included in the restrictive covenant or in the,
yeah,
the actual
could,
mitigation.
Well, they could say, we just won't approve it.
Yes, so part of the banking instrument is to establish what kind of upstream stormwater controls and watershed protections are in place to address that. So for Forsyth County and for a lot of Metro Atlanta communities, there are updated stormwater design requirements in place that have really been in place since about 2001 that basically help to better manage and treat stormwater from a site when you develop it. So those controls are put in place to prevent kind of the continual issues that we see downstream when you have just unchecked stormwater flowing across surfaces where it can't infiltrate.
I have one more question. Help me to understand the difference between wetland and floodplain, because when I look at the Etowah and our property on the Chattahoochee, both are very floodplain areas, but they don't equate to wetland credits necessarily?
Not necessarily. Many times, particularly for the Etowah and Big Creek, what you see is actually a lot of floodplain wetlands. So the floodplain is the area within a certain corridor based on topography of the stream that's really defined by, does it flood at certain intervals, certain storm events. So it doesn't necessarily have to flood or inundate frequently enough to become a wetland. But it is more likely because you've got the hydrology. So a wetland gets distinguished from floodplain because of vegetation and inundation, so the saturation and the high water table, and then soil conditions that support kind of the soil chemistry and in some cases the vegetation and the potential for infiltration that a wetland would.
So I was thinking we'd have a lot more wetland credit than what we've had, because it does flood. I mean, Big Creek Greenway floods constantly.
So there's another distinction that's important, and Kevin does a great job explaining this, but basically if you have a wetland and you have a degraded, maybe it's a degraded wetland where you don't necessarily have large bottomland forest trees, which is what we think of as kind of your high quality wetland. Let's say it's invasive plant species and maybe some less mature trees or even just shrub. So if you have a wetland like that, if there's hydrology there, so if it's, what am I saying that? I mean, if there's enough stormwater flow or groundwater or flooding that happens in that area to support soils and the vegetation that you find in the wetland, it's still a wetland, so the ability to provide ecological lift by restoring it even more than it already is gets reduced. So the ideal wetland restoration site is actually usually farmland where maybe in the past land has been drained, so you've got ditches that have been put in place to drain the land in a different way than it was historically. And you can basically go in and plug those ditches and restore the hydrology, so increase the duration and the inundation of water sitting on the site. And that will then establish the soils, reestablish the soils and the vegetation. And that's typically the ideal situation, the most cost-effective way to generate wetland credits.
Any other questions? Is there a motion from the board? Anything on this wetland? Thank you for the presentation.
Thank you.
Thanks. Item 4 has been postponed to April. Item 5, request for part-time property appraisal.
That's me. I just Afternoon, Board. Tim, good to see you again. I'm coming today to ask if you would please allow me to hire a part-time, 28-hour part-time appraiser back. A little background, in 2008, during the budget crisis and reduction in economy falling, I laid off 9 members of my staff at that time to help all the way around budget economy, and the workload was decreasing. As the permit activity has begun to increase again, it is beginning to be difficult for the staff to continue to keep pace and do adequate reviews. One of the things we have noticed is that during the downturn in the economy, a lot of people did things on the inside of their houses, finishing basements, improvements that sometimes weren't permitted and a little more difficult to find. So we need a little help to try to get us through this year. This position was not budgeted, but I did go through my budget and find the money to move. Finance has been kind enough to move the money for me, so I can fund the position. There would be no benefits, and I will look at including this back in the 2014 budget as a possible full-time position.
What does the part-time position cost?
It's $14.82 an hour. It's the total of about $17,030.
I make a motion that we approve the request for part-time property appraiser one position for the tax assessor.
Second. Got a motion second to approve the part-time position at $17,013.36. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Thank you. Lady and gentlemen now.
5-0. Item 6, renewal of Motorola service agreement. Power location and radio equipment for the period of 3-1-13 through 12-31-13. I ask T, Department of Procurement.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, I'm Barbara Garrett, and so I'm representing the procurement department today. This is the renewal for the Motorola service agreement from March the 1st through December 31st. This agreement covers the 4 towers that provides the 911 communications and the radio equipment used by all emergency personnel in the county. Approval to issue a purchase order to Motorola in the amount of $309,828.98 for the service agreement renewal, with permission for the county manager to sign the purchase order as well as the service agreement, and this is time sensitive.
Looks like we saved almost $170,000 in last year, or the budget.
I think they're going to save around $126,000 since they merged with Cobb County.
There's one more item to come out of that line.
Are we looking for a total savings of 126? Any questions? I hear a motion.
Make a motion to approve. Issue the purchase order to Motorola in the amount of $309,828.98 for service agreement. Permission for the county manager to sign the service agreement. Is this time sensitive?
Yes, it is.
Time sensitive.
Time sensitive. Any more discussion? We have a motion and a second by time sensitive item to renew the Motorola service agreement. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? 5-0. Item 7, the renewal of RMS, JMS, FBR, GAGIC, Identics Interface and Bind Interface Software.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, this is the renewal for calendar year 2013 through Intergraph. It covers the records management system as well as the jail management system, the field-based reporting, the crime analysis GIS software, the fingerprint system, and the victim notification system. And we request approval to issue a purchase order in the amount of $72,501.24 to Intergraph.
And we have checked with the sheriff, and
yes, ma'am.
And he does is good with him.
Yes, ma'am. And the fire department as well.
Any other questions? Do I hear a motion? It's not time sensitive.
No, sir, it's not time sensitive.
I'll make a motion, Mr. Chairman, that we renew the RMS JMS index interface and non-interface software maintenance with Intergraph Corporation for the IST department as presented to us in our books today for the amount $72,501.24.
Second. Now, a motion and a second for the renewal. Any other discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? 5-0. Item 8, do a renewal of mobile crime software maintenance with Interact Public Safety Systems.
Mr. Chairman and members of the board, this is the renewal of the mobile crime agent IPSP software maintenance with Interact Public Safety for calendar year 2013. The mobile crime is a computer-aided dispatch software that is currently used by the fire and the FCSO to receive dispatches to their mobile data terminals, as well as running their GCIC and NCIC queries, which is the tags, driver's license, et cetera. Request that approval to issue a purchase order to Interact Public Safety in the amount of $54,875. And this also has been approved by the sheriff and the fire to go back to Interact.
Not time sensitive.
No, sir.
Any questions from the board? Do we hear a motion?
Make a motion we approve to issue the purchase order Interact Public Safety Systems in the amount of $4,875 for this software maintenance renewal as presented.
I hear a second. I have a motion and a second for the renewal of mobile crime maintenance. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? 5-0.
Thank you.
Item 9, presentation of preliminary outline regarding proposal for administrative variance procedures.
I'm here today to discuss a proposal. You have an outline before you for the prospect of looking at having administrative variances. This is part of the package we've been working on for our user-friendly initiatives within the planning department. So the outline would be, it would include up to 15% for certain items, including maximum building height, building setbacks, and select buffers, which would include the residential exterior buffer for major subdivisions, the Georgia 400 buffer, large-scale retail, senior housing buffers, as well as side and rear buffer requirements across districts. The way it would work is it would have to fall in that parameter of the 15% for these items. The cost would be comparable to our current variance request before the CBA. The application requirements would be the same. And the considerations for a decision would also mirror the current considerations used by the CBA. If for any reason an applicant would want to an appeal in a decision of an administrative variance, they would go to the CBA. We're looking today for board feedback. If this is something that you're interested in pursuing, we can go ahead, make a UDC draft, and move forward to the public hearing schedule. Based on our current round of edits, that would mean we could get before the PC in May. And we would also want to combine potentially these changes with extending permit life, which has already gone through the board, again, part of that user-friendly initiative too, so we could wrap those two together.
So do you feel this is our user-friendly thing? I mean, it's going to help with the developers?
Yes, it would allow, you know, flexibility for them not to have to go before an actual board. At the same time, for anything, you know, above 15%, they would still need to go to the ZBA. And of course, items such as riparian buffers would not be addressed by administrative review.
Any questions?
A couple. I am good with everything on here, with the exception of the administrative ability to give 15% already, something that's already 5 feet. That's already so tight and so minimal, I don't know that should be included.
Was it up to, what was the thing, Todd? You said you don't like it at 5 feet?
Yeah, because some of our zonings already allow a 5-foot sideline.
But it's 5 foot plus 15, it's 20 total.
some of them are less than that. That's what I'm getting at. The ones that are less than that already have an issue with fire code, and they already have certain things that's come into play. When you get down to a certain distance, I think it's less than 15, they require some entrance materials, offset of windows. And the problem is if they didn't put those items into play and now they come to the variance afterwards, where does that leave them making the ability to drop at 15% more and they still haven't complied with those new fire items that we've all agreed should be in?
I think is fire items part of those things now?
Tom, you understand where I'm coming from on that? If we're already borderline and they didn't have to put them in and they weren't part of a zoning because they were just on the edge of not having to do it, but then they come back later for variance and it would put them into that window and now they don't have on the house, what do we do then?
In the planning department, we're always going to default to the building code anyways, and that's our fallback, that we rely on the building code. The zoning conditions about offset windows and materials, those are things above and beyond. But I think it's a valid point that if we wanted to say, an exception to this proposed rule being a setback would never be less than 5 feet to a property line, we can add that.
Without coming to us. I mean, several of our new zonings recently, we added in those as part of the conditions. That if there was, I think, less than 15 feet, we all agreed, we added in, we all voted 5-0 or most, I think everything so far, that was less than 15 feet between houses, that they had the symmetrical materials and the offset windows whenever the homes are too close, less than 15 feet. If I look back, I need to give you a puzzled look, but. And the fire chief was there and they explained why that was necessary. And we all agreed and we all sent that through a bunch of times. So the question is, how do we monitor that if one was 20 feet apart now they're coming, but they won't only be, or 15, right at the edge of the 15 feet, and now they want to get less than that and they haven't put those items into play.
Wouldn't be an issue for us to exempt a certain, not to go.
At that moment, y'all just be cautious at that and maybe.
Still have to be inspected.
I know, and maybe you take that consideration when you're doing your administrative considerations. And I'm fine with that too, because I trust your department.
We do, and
fire marshal's been inspected. Is it close or too close?
We do have one of the considerations. It will not be detrimental to the public safety, health, or welfare of the public. So that is one of the considerations that would have to come into play before the granting of any variance. And that's true currently for the ZBA and would be true for staff as well.
As long as you all have that safety net where you can make that decision on that kind of the way it sits.
We also are planning on this being a way to redesign the neighborhood. We're seeing it as something happened in the field or one particular lot where things just don't work out. They had the chance to come into our office and do this administratively. Less items on the board's agenda, less work for the staff to process, quicker turnaround for the applicant.
We're trying for this to be the whole subdivision, just individual lines.
You're right. If we see someone come in time and again for the same thing, and it looks like they're basically trying to redesign their neighborhood through my office, we're going to say, no, go upstairs, try to get that done upstairs.
Isn't that limited? My reading of this is they can't have on more than 15% of the lots.
When we prepared that, the concept was 15% performance standard.
But it could be for the whole neighborhood then.
I kind of like
it. Where it wouldn't be for the whole neighborhood is already in the ordinance. It says a variance shall not have the effect of negating any of the various purposes and intentions of this code. And if someone came to me time and again for every lot to say, we want to take it from 10 down to 8.5 for a side setback, we'd say, you're basically trying to rewrite the code, and that doesn't happen at a staff level. That needs to go upstairs.
But just like the one we just heard on Ryland, where their whole subdivision was a particular way, and they came and they added 7 or 8 more lots, and they wanted the same setbacks as they had previously, they could have gone to you guys with this in place, and you could have approved that. Instead of it coming to the board,
that would be more than 15%.
We would have a bit of a feel. We'd have to feel that one out a bit. I think that particular one had 30 something lots,
so it might have been too much.
That one very likely might set up here.
We have to just trust Mr. Brown and his staff to pick these out. There's someone trying to get by with something.
Yep, I'm good with it.
I'm
good with it too.
Mm-hmm. What about somebody comes in and says, I have a variance, I'd like to drop it, and then have you vary it, essentially the same thing, differently?
I could see that if their variance only gave them 10% and they wanted that last 5, I envision that we could do that. We still can't go less than 15. We can knock 15% off the performance standard that's in our zoning ordinance.
So you can get rid of variances there also?
Get rid of, maybe I didn't understand the question.
I said that the person has some sort of a variance now. Mm-hmm. He comes in and says, remove this variance. And does this allow you to do that only then to give him a more, call it lenient variance, minutes after you remove the variance that's already been put on there, hopefully for thoughtful reasons?
I don't think I'd have to remove it. I don't see it giving me the ability to remove a variance, but I always, it would give me the ability to knock 15% off the performance standard.
Of what the variance states or what the
what's in the code.
Okay.
So we had a 10-foot side setback required. Someone had already received a variance to take it to 9. It came to me, I could take it down to 8.5.
So they wouldn't want to do away the variance because you wouldn't get as much. Don't be time.
Well, that's what I wanted to be clear of. I wasn't sure whether you meant 15%. More of the variance that he already had, you know.
15% off of the performance standard in our zoning ordinance, and before we get to hearing, we'll take a look. If we think that's not clear, we'll make sure that's clear in there.
And I guess the other part is, if a person, let's just say, has a variance, I mean, you almost become like the ZBA in, if you have the ability to just drop the variance that was already written, just get rid of this one, okay, it's no longer buried. I guess that would be okay because then it falls back to the performance standard. Is that right?
Yeah.
All right, I guess I don't have a problem with that.
It's not required.
Tom, we had talked about making the variance not run out. Remember in our meeting we had discussed that?
Our subdivisions, that's something, since we're dealing with permit life extensions as well, we could work that into these roundabouts.
That's
wouldn't be an issue.
Don't y'all like
that? Yeah, once you get a variance, why does it go away?
Once you got a variance, why is it disappeared? Why didn't it go with the zoning conditions? Do y'all have any problem with that?
Well, we could add that to the lot when she talked about the lot.
Yes,
yeah. I agree.
Okay. And when we brought that up before, we talked about we want to differentiate between the variances that are part of a rezoning request. Those have no expiration. But a standalone variance granted by the ZBA still had an expiration. We need to hear from the Board of Commissioners what the preference was there.
Tom, are you looking for a motion to go ahead and take this to the Planning and Zoning?
Yeah, we had heard long ago from the Board that there was some interest in doing this. We finally got the draft together and we're here to hear if it's ready to go to a public hearing.
Any more questions?
Have a motion. May I ask a question?
Yes, sir.
Just to Commissioner Boff. What if there was a variance granted by the ZBA or the board previously that was close to what could be administratively provided, and there were conditions attached to it? And if an applicant comes in and said, well, I'd like to waive that variance, but I'd like you to grant me a staff variance. Is that sort of what you were thinking of, though, or is that not? I mean, I guess I'm just wondering if there's already been a variance granted that had conditions, and at some point in the past, somebody thought those conditions made a good idea. Maybe they don't make as good idea now, but is that what you were thinking of? Was a
potential? I mean, you know, sometimes you can easily explain why variances or conditions are in there, and other times you can't. Ideally, you should always, you know, somebody should always be able to say, here's why this was important, at least at the time. And to just suddenly waltz in and something that maybe a neighborhood fought very hard to get put in there is gone. Also, I am not expert enough in the UDC to know all flavors and subtleties of variances, which might suddenly, like I wasn't thinking of a variance with conditions. As a perfect example.
Well, that may be in whether you would want to draft the code such that if a variance has already been provided addressing that specific issue, that may be something you don't want staff to fool with, or you may want them to have it, or you may just give them their discretion. I mean, they're going to know sort of what the intention was, but anyway, I don't mean to get in that far in the weeds on it, but that's what I thought.
I think it could be a at staff discretion, but I assume we could draft the code to say we couldn't drop conditions. We could only look at the percentage amount. That's another option.
The tough position would be, though, is if they came in looking for a 20% variance with conditions, but now they're saying, well, we'll do 10 if it's just by you.
Yes, right.
And you may feel like, you know, that's more in line with the code. Mm-hmm. We want to do that. So.
Good. And Tom, answering your question that you brought up a minute ago, I feel like the board on the ZBA, you were talking about the variances by them. I mean, didn't y'all agree to make those go with the zoning and not make them be on a different timetable?
They should. Just,
all, there's just no expiration on any of
them.
On
any.
Is the board satisfied with the presentation that presented? Ready to move on with it?
Good job.
To a public hearing?
Yeah, do you have a motion? Is that it?
Move that we take the next available public hearing.
Second.
Is that correct, Kim?
Yep. It is, sir. That'll be before part of the planning commission.
Yes, and it will be in May.
Right. We have a motion and a second to proceed with this presentation and to the planning commission. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? 5-0. Item 10, presentation and preliminary outline of Buford Highway.
Go ahead and direct you to the map in your books at the request of Commissioner Boff. We've taken a look at the Buford Highway corridor from the city limits to the county line of the river. And what you're seeing right now is the blue line represents a 500-foot swath, so it's 250 feet out from the center line of the road on both sides. So in looking at a potential district area, this would be the area, and then the parcels would be affecting are outlined in yellow, but it would only be for that 250-foot width. In terms of the potential components of the overlay, what was discussed was additional landscape strips for non-residential uses, electronic signage control, performance standards for fuel stations and vehicle-related establishments, and outdoor lighting regulations. At this time, we've just produced an outline, not an actual draft. We would need to hear from the board if the board is interested to craft an actual draft that we would then bring back to you in a work session.
Are you asking for details at this point or to work the details out?
We just need, the staff just needs direction if this is the desire of the board to move forward with the actual.
Yeah, I mean, my idea is to just not really do too terribly much. I think you'll agree that was pretty much our conversation. This is, to me, this is the time to do it because we're getting somewhat where you can see the end zone for the full four laning of this. Therefore, I would make a recommendation that we flesh this out more.
Are we going to any kind of, do we have a second discussion?
I'll do a second for discussion. Is number one, the 500 feet, is that adequate distance?
I'm open to suggestions. There is, to me, there's nothing magic about the number 500. It was just I kind of think a typical or representative number of what's happened in other places.
I think 500 feet.
Does 500 cover the depth of most commercial
buildings? Yeah, it should cover most. The fronts of any commercial building we're going to see.
If we're looking at signage and landscape strips, it would absolutely cover it. If you're looking at a large parcel, it would have to go out parcels and maybe a larger
establishment.
This isn't Peachtree Parkway.
Yeah. I realize. I don't know if you want to make sure you have to get
it. I appreciate
that. To hear?
I like it better the way Jim's got it, and it's not so restrictive. I mean, just
I
when our economy is coming
but
back,
if you
don't
cover
do
what you cover, you got another.
Push it back.
On this one, would you have your 550 feet?
These
definitely.
A lot of those is already developed in there.
Yeah. They,
but more to come,
I definitely appreciate
I think
I'm okay.
Very good.
I mean, it's going to be kind of not real heavy overlay, just a bit medium.
That's right.
Okay.
Now the road will be widened. It'll go out to bid this fall from samples down to the river. So we're looking at construction in early 2014. So, you know, from the center line would be the expanded road as well. So we can always revisit the
road.
So what, do you need a motion or?
Yeah, you made the motion.
Okay.
Yes, that.
Second for discussion.
And we would come back to a board work session to review the draft.
Right back on conditions for us. That's great. Any more discussion? We have a motion and a second. Those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? 5-0.
Thank you.
Thank
you.
Thank you. Item 11, alcohol ordinance modifications. Ms. Pop?
Yes.
I thought you wanted to hold on to this maybe once a quarter or twice a year.
Boy, go Tom.
All right. Proposed changes to the alcohol ordinance. These came out of some discussions with Commissioner Mills. We talked about this back in January. At that time, a lot of the discussion focused on the possible creation of an alcohol licensing board. Some of the comments we received back was, well, based on the current volume of administrative hearings we've been having in the last few months, it may not justify the cost right now of putting in place that alcohol licensing board or using the ZBA to function in that role. So the proposal we've come back with today takes that licensing board out of the equation as far as an ordinance change, but it does acknowledge that we should keep an eye on it. And later this year, if we see the volume pick up, we could return to that discussion and decide at that time if it's needed. Putting that issue aside, the issues that remain are ones that are focused on freeing up time for both the Board of Commissioners by having fewer agenda requests, and freeing up time with the staff by having fewer items we have to put on the board's agenda. Because even though what you'll hear are some things where the staff will be doing the work, it's a lot less work to process that administratively ourselves than it is to process it and bring it up to an administrative hearing, the formality of that process. So there are seven main changes. The first is that the staff, with some limited exceptions, the staff could sign off on a change to the name licensee. We see a lot of those. We saw one just at the last meeting. The Publix was changing, they got a new manager, a new person shows up. The proposal is, could we do that at the staff level?
Long as there's no citations.
And that's in there. Yes, that's in there. Let's see the details. There's a clean criminal history for the applicant, and no more than one citation has been issued at the location in the last 2 years. The second one is that changes to the corporation or partnership could be approved by the staff with similar limitations. The third is, rather than just some, all employee violations processed at the staff level with the ability to appeal to the Board of Commissioners. The other thing that does is, rather than identify a range for the suspension period, it just states a specific date. So many days, 15 days, 30 days, 1 year. So there's no discretion on the staff's part. If they got the citation, here's the suspension, formula driven, done. The fourth being suspension signs, dropping the requirement to post suspension signs at the outlet while they're under suspension. A few reasons. One, just the legwork of doing that. Two, sometimes the short turnaround where we'll have a hearing Thursday night and the suspension might start Friday or Monday. It's difficult to post those. And also we rely on what we always have is field enforcement. The sheriff's office knows the license, the outlets that are being suspended. And you can bet, not always, but very often, they are paying them a visit during their suspension to make sure they're not selling during that suspension period. The fifth is creating a fee. We currently don't have a fee for alcohol sales IDs. Those are the ID cards used for employees, or a fee for appeals. And we're proposing a fee the same as a normal appeal, $250, $25 for the alcohol sales ID. The sixth proposal is to reduce the fee for a wholesale alcohol license down to $100. Again, that was a thought process behind that, was trying to put a cost more appropriate to the cost of putting on the community. And while the package and the consumption outlets do put a more direct cost on the community, the wholesalers do not put that direct cost on the community.
Yeah, that $4,000 was out of line. I mean, that was insane, really.
Doug had asked at a gender review that we look around at smaller communities, what they charge, and there's some good variation, but a lot of them do have the $500, $700 to several thousand dollar type fees. So
why are we wanting to go all the way down to 100 then?
Well, we have none of them here, and we have one here now, one wine wholesaler. And the thought was, in these businesses, it's very hard to tie the cost of the license to the cost they're putting on the community. Come Friday night, the same amount of beer is being consumed in the county, whether the wholesalers are located in our county paying property taxes or located in Fulton County.
Gotcha.
No doubt.
Seven is, in the last general change that you'll see, is to allow my staff to communicate by applicants through email rather than certified mailing and return receipt mailing. That would take some time to work in. We'd have to collect that information from the applicants over a period of a year or two. But once we had it, it would stay safe. Cost and staff time.
Sure would.
I have realized that, but you think it's adequate notification if they would be suspended license?
Put it on their next application. Yeah. They have to provide the next application that they file. Renewal. They have to provide it.
As it is now, we end up asking him, did they get the thing? Did they sign it? Absolutely. Did they return it?
Right.
Now he's going to say, I have no idea whether they got the email or not.
Wait,
they
say now,
respond. They don't respond?
No, he doesn't know whether, you don't know whether an email gets delivered or not.
That's correct. That's you can do question. A delivery receipt.
Ken, is that legal? I don't know that that's
a universal standard on all ISPs.
Email doesn't have the same. I mean, if y'all are asking me sort of what the standard is in a courtroom, a regular U.S. post office parcel dropped in a mail with the correct address and proper postage has a presumption of having been delivered.
Which is the same thing as an email.
Although we're
I
not
don't actually, think email we're, has we're, a presumption.
We're not actually, they've already been through their trial, right? We don't have to have that standard that level of standard. I'm not against the email, I'm just saying.
But you're getting ready to suspend.
I'm saying we grill you every time about the mail, which legally Ken is saying is the sine qua non, if you will, of how to deliver stuff and go into this, in which nobody has, they will have any idea whether it was ever delivered or not.
Well, and we've seen how ineffective the mail
is. They don't show up for the mail.
Mail it to an apartment at four college students
like this
at, or a store.
Yeah, yes. But now we're going to say, Tom, did you send an email? Yes, I did. Did they get it? I have no idea. Well, every time.
He can't say.
Now
he
remember, though, you all are looking for a standard from Tom in those meetings that is even higher than what the law, because you all ask him, you know, how do you know they got it? Because they sent them certified mail. Y'all are looking for that return receipt to have been signed.
Yeah.
And yeah. A lot of folks that get certified mail just don't pick it up.
That's right. They don't pick it up. And then some of them sign it without knowing what it is. Roommates.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Employees.
But still, it's a standard which is acceptable. I mean, it gives me a better comfort before we suspend and also suspend.
Well, let me ask you this. If on the application it said, list the email for all contacts, and it says, you know, joe@gmail.com, and I say, Tom, did you send it to joe@gmail.com, and he says, yes, I did, I think we're done. It's what they put down, it's where he sent it, and if it didn't get there, that's not our fault.
Part of asking for email would be making the applicant also where they need to keep it current. So we're asking this from you. We're going to communicate through this as a means of communication with you, and you need to keep it current.
Let me ask Ken, you said we put a higher burden of proof on Tom. Do we even have to ask Tom the question, did they get it?
No, you don't, but I mean, you all do that. Let's just be candid. You all do that out of a sense of fair play, because you all want to know why someone's not at the meeting, and so giving them the benefit of the doubt, you all want to know, did they even know what we were doing tonight? That's why you all ask. It's a reasonable question, but I'm just saying, these people come in and apply for a license, a privilege to do business in the county. They're supposed to keep their addresses updated. And so when we send them a notice, we have every right to rely on the address that is in our file. And if the address is wrong, candidly, the fault is theirs, not ours. I'm just saying that you all smack into that out there, though. Y'all get very uncomfortable taking away somebody's livelihood. It's not their defense.
With some people having to filters they have on their email system, some really make a strict filtering system, it can bump their email straight to their spam and they'll never see it.
We don't know if they'll see their certified mail.
just saying, I think it raises, if you're okay with.
I'm okay, if it communicated by email today, we'll do certified mail.
And if Tom says there's a problem, and that we can change that.
And we'll see it too, and just keep us informed if you see that.
Yeah. And we also have, these people are required to be familiar with our ordinance as part of being a license holder. And in the ordinance, it says, if you get a citation, you're going to have a hearing. They have a little bit of burden on them as well to know that hearing's coming, and I better be calling up the office to find out when it is, be on the lookout, make sure I get there. If it's important, I just want to make the sound that they show up in front of you.
Email may work better.
Tom, when we were in agenda review, we had talked about the $25 alcohol sales ID fee, and I thought you mentioned something about the state.
There was a change.
Might be putting a fee.
There was a change in the state fee for processing fingerprints, and I talked to Deborah about it. The change was so small that I feel our $350 investigative fee already covers it, and okay. I don't need an additional change.
Okay, I just want to make sure that cost is covered.
Does anybody have any other questions about this?
The only thing, going back just for a second, I'm sorry, is that it was a compromise. I could live with just that we send it out regular mail. If
an email and regular mail?
No, just mail. I'd certify it, but not in mail.
I regular mail doesn't give you confirmation. Email.
I think, how about allowing both of them through email and regular mail, if that makes you happy.
I do like that.
Not certified. He can just mail it from his office without having one post office.
Allowing either or requiring both?
Requiring both, email and regular mail.
So the regular stamp.
I have my preference is more if we do that, then stick with what we got.
Are you going to go certified?
No. Staff time is just, we're getting so busy down there. Staff
yeah,
time
we've
is
taken
just stealing
one
up against.
Turns into two.
I don't want to double it.
We don't email. Go email and see how it goes.
I'm comfortable. If we want to go to mail, that's fine. And we'll clarify it doesn't need to be certified or it doesn't need to be return receipt. If we're not comfortable with email, but I'd ask that we don't do both.
Are you comfortable with email, Ian?
I'll go with
you. Okay, so the direction is to go with email only.
Yes, sir. You need a motion, Tom, directive, or what?
Please, I'd like a motion to say we're comfortable with this moving to public hearing.
With email, item 7, added to email only.
So moved.
Second for discussion.
Discussion.
Actually, one more question. On the violations, whatever they are, it doesn't matter which one we're talking about. We also make a big deal of, well, let's see, how about a Tuesday from next Thursday? When will this actually start?
We have nothing in there now to cover that.
Why don't you think about that? I know you want to get away from the signs on there.
But yeah, if for some reason
start
it was
on my day
it's 2 weeks from the date of your processing date, that would give somebody time to go. I'm not saying 2 weeks is the right number.
Okay.
Don't you have a 30-day time frame for repeal?
Yeah, we actually have. Let me. I'll bring something to Harry that they contemplate. Just keep him warning.
First Monday after 30 days is up after the appeal or something to that effect.
And leave Tom enough room to be flexible.
He's going to pick it. He knows his staff.
We have a motion and a second now to proceed with this. Tom's office. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0. Item 12, moratorium related to home-based businesses. Tom?
Yes, sir. Home businesses in our county, we have a home occupation section that allows certain small-scale businesses to be operated from someone's home. And currently in there, there's a section that prohibits work on internal combustion engines. Back in December, the board adopted a moratorium on this. And in February, that moratorium was extended. The moratorium basically pulls that restriction out of the ordinance for the duration of the moratorium and allows work on an internal combustion engine. This moratorium was first developed for a specific property owner that had home occupation and had over time outgrown the scale of what was allowed. an application has already been submitted for that property owner or business owner to reapply. And for all purposes, the intent of why this moratorium was first put in place has been satisfied. Now, we heard at the hearing, we had one person speak thinking that maybe we should allow, always in the future, allow work on an internal combustion engine with certain limitations. Maybe if it's zone agricultural over 5 acres, maybe 2 acres, whatever the threshold was. My recommendation is that I don't see this as a, right now, as a pressing, time-sensitive issue. My recommendation is either that the board, if they think we don't need a change, that would be fine. If we think we do need a change, I would ask that we put it on the back burner and let me tie it in with the next round of UDC changes rather than running this through as an individual change. We've got almost 6 or 7 different UDC changes in the works right now. It's quite a handful to keep track of them all. I'd like to see this put off if we're comfortable with it, or just acknowledge that we don't want it to consider the change.
And the only reason we had the moratorium in place was basically for this business, this jet ski business, that was not complying and giving them time to get an application in.
That was the driving force behind it, yes.
And now they have applied. So you just want a motion from us to remove the moratorium, or?
I don't even think we need that. We can just let the moratorium, it was a 90-day moratorium. We can just let it run its course.
Okay. You need a motion?
Nope. I don't need a motion.
Let it expire.
Okay. Any other questions? Everybody satisfied? We'll let it die. Item 13, proposed modifications to rest 3 and rest 4.
Okay, my final item for today. Back in February, Board of Commissioners work session, we had talked and I got direction to begin work on a unified development code change to add a new residential zoning classification, and we at that time, for lack of a better name, we were calling it Res 3.5. It was similar to Res 3, but it had a smaller lot, lower density, and a larger home size. Since that day at the work session in February, had some discussions about, well, is that Res 3.5 the best option, or would we be better off modifying Res 3 to get Res 3 closer to what we envision as being needed in the county? Some of the drawbacks of the 3.5 concept, one, it's not identified in our comprehensive plan. That's not a deal breaker, but again, it's a little bit of an awkwardness where it doesn't show up in the comprehensive plan as where it's appropriate in the county. The other question we had was, will the creation of Res 3.5 essentially make Res 3 obsolete? No one ever asked for it again. And we added a new thing just to create something else that clutters up the ordinance and never gets used. And also the Res 3.5 concept, it added to the theme of the numbering system being somewhat meaningless. Traditionally, the numbering system in our residential zoning districts, the higher the number, meant the higher the density. In this case, it would have been the reverse, where 3.5 was at a lower density than 3, although a smaller lot size. Now, some of the if we just change Res 3, some of the drawbacks of changing Res 3 is we would be providing these performance standards to all existing Res 3s, zonings in the county. The smaller lot size, the lower density, and the higher minimum home size. I need to hear from the Board of Commissioners if we want to continue with 3.5, the path we're on, or if before we run that first ad and post notice for that first public hearing, change gears and go with Res 3. The proposal before you in your books would take the minimum lot size from 14,500 down to 11,000. It would take the maximum density from 2.5 down to 2.2. And it would take the minimum home size from 1,250 up to 2,000. And then there was one similar change to Res 4, increasing the minimum home size there.
I think this is, are you finished?
I am.
Thank you very much. I think this is a good idea. I think that if we put in that 3.5, you know, they're just going to gravitate to that 3.5 category. It makes a good point that it's not in our comp plan. You know, what we're hearing is you have Res 3, which is 9,000 square foot lots, or used to be 9,000 square foot lots, and it might be on two or three different sides of a piece of property. And so people are saying, well, I just don't want 9,000 square foot lots on. Can I do a Res 4?
Which lowers the requirements in other areas.
Which lowers the requirements in other areas, but I'll commit to 8,000 or 9,000 square foot lots. So I think that if we make the lot size or allow the lot size to be smaller, it would actually probably make the property more valuable. But if we make the density less, we're not going to get any more houses. And then if we look at the square footage of the house, we're certainly going to get
better
house.
So you're proposing by you're lowering the square footage of the lot,
yeah,
but you're also lowering the density.
That's right.
Which forces more green space.
That's right. Yeah.
Which gets more
lot. Gives them more flexibility.
Is that
on
necessarily
lot
true?
You have 70 square feet an acre. You've lowered your density of use of it, so it's going to have to leave something left.
It can be hard to tell. First of all, these are minimum lot sizes. You can never stop. It's never going to stop someone from deciding they want a few lots that are larger.
And they probably do.
Or just dedicating more area to the pool and tennis court.
So the market will dictate that a lot.
Your density for reducing the amount of homes you have.
So what? But you agree with 11,000, or you want to go down?
I was thinking, and he just hear me out, because Tom has been very helpful to me on this. But I was thinking we'd do it at 10,500, but then we would move over to the Res 4 category and take that lot size up.
Well,
that way, when they come in and say, "Look, I'd like a Res 4, but I want 9,000," we'll say, "Look, let's just say it was 7,500 in Res 4. You know, I'd like, well, Res 4 is 1,500 square feet south of 9,000, and 10,500 is 1,500 north of it." You could say, "Look, 10,500 is just as close as the 7,500 and the Res 4. Do Res 3.
I think if you're finding a balance on what's fair for the square footage of lots, for every foot you reduce Res 3, you should also raise Res 4 equal. Until you find your balance and they come closer.
Well, that's what this does. No,
it doesn't.
If you take Res 3 down to 10 and add 4, I mean, it makes Res 4 and Res 3 almost the same thing.
That's why I'm saying Res 3, you're lowering it too much.
But I think 10,500 is
if you're lowering the density.
Yeah.
You're not getting any more houses. You're just giving the flexibility.
I like it because they're going up on the house size.
We'll go up on the house size.
So we can do that also, but you can also still lower your Res 3 by 2,000 feet, raise Res 4 by 2,000 feet, and then I'd be willing to give past that compromise and lower your Res 3 a little bit as long as you raise your Res 4 square footage minimum.
I think people are going to ask for, I think they're going to ask Res 4 density with a lower lot. Because
we want to encourage them for the Res 3 because it's better.
It's better.
That's right.
It's better.
It's a bigger house.
Like, we want to give them the incentive to go with the better zone.
We get less density. We get less density. We, in theory, get more green space. And that's what we call medium size housing, where if you get into Res 4, 6,000 square feet.
You don't want to raise the square footage of the lot for Res 4?
Well, sure I do. You should need a little bit, not equal it to the other one.
You need to talk about this too a little bit, and I don't know if you have tools to know this, but if you increase the green space, which generally people say sounds like a great idea, the way these things get taxed, unless the value goes into each of the individual units, you end up with a net tax loss because the green space is taxed as if it was completely worthless, including the outbuildings and everything else. So this isn't just a matter of, wouldn't it be nice to have this size?
It shouldn't be no outbuildings in the green space.
What's that?
It should be an outbuildings in the green space.
Right? No, like a clubhouse or something.
Well, clubhouse or density, you get more houses in the
space. Mm-hmm. Okay. My point is that this isn't
and I don't know that how we would analyze this necessarily, but this isn't just about what size box goes on what size lot. It's also if you end up making the lots really small and the value doesn't come out of the house, the unit somebody buys, then you've just taken all this acreage that had a value before, might have been a house, turned it into green space, and it has no tax value
but
whatsoever.
That's why they're raising the square footage of homes to make the homes more valuable.
Yeah.
But also, with green space, you can control it. If you turn these green space, if you combine them with lots, then once they sell, you got people can cut every tree down out there they want to. You can't control people cutting all trees down.
And that's a shame, but it's true.
Your stream banks are at risk if you don't have protected green areas.
Like the supply to places that don't have streams.
Well, every piece of land has.
So watch, watch.
So why are you looking at the size on four?
On four, at least 7,500 square feet for a lot.
8,000?
10,000.
8,000?
I guess the, and you raise the price, you raise the size of the house 400 square feet already.
Yep.
Yeah.
I'm not keen on how low you're making rest three that on these.
Oh, which one?
10,500, that's getting way low.
But everybody that comes before us, they're all trying to get 9,000.
There are so many tracts of land that are already
zoned. They're not trying to get anything that's not already zoned for that. And that's why they get to keep that.
That's right.
There are so many tracts of land that are zoned with 9,000 square foot lots. And you can make a case for, I'm buying a piece of property next to this, I'd like to have similar lots. Okay, so.
Where you see change.
So why not say, okay, you can have close to the same lot, but you get less density. Because what difference does it make what size, I mean, really, truly, what size the lot is and what if you're controlling the density? The market will drive the lot size. When a builder goes in and says, well, I'm next to, you know, a CR1, you know, and I'm gonna do a res 3, you know, some of my lots are gonna be 15,000 square feet. Some of my lots are gonna be 13,000. Look at the Ryland one we did down there on, next to Old Atlantic Club. You know, they have some very large lots, and then they taper some down, and then they taper some down in different phases. So I think it's, you know, it just gives more flexibility, but we're controlling the density. When you say, okay, we'll make lots smaller, you immediately think more houses. But if you control the density, you're making, it's less houses.
Yeah, I get it, but I still think you should raise your res 4. If you're going to lower res 3 by 2,500 or 3,500, I think it's very reasonable to ask res 4 comes up 2,000.
I said 7,500.
So we're not far off.
8,000.
If you'll go with 10,500 and res 3,
It's a drop of 4,000 square feet, but you're only willing to raise res 3 up 2,000.
Well, let's hear his motion. Go ahead.
All right, go ahead.
I'm going to move that we move the public hearing with a proposal of res 3 category 3 changes. Lot size being 10,500 square feet. The density or units per acre being lowered from 2.5 to 2.2. And the minimum house size being brought up from 1,250 feet to 2,000 square feet. I'm going to move that we, in addition, that we take the res 4 lot size from 6,000 square feet to 8,000 square feet, and the minimum house size from 800 square feet to 1,250 square feet. And we didn't talk about it, but I'd like to see us go ahead and take the 4 units an acre and reduce that to 3.6 units.
3.4.
That's his motion.
Is that your reservoir?
Is that a motion?
That's his motion. Do we have a second for discussion?
Second.
Discussion.
Tom, I'd like to hear if you're not going to hurt my feelings, what do you think of this?
So the only thing that was significantly different was the only thing significantly different was lowering Res 4 down to 3.6. And my only comment is you expect Ken and I to be back here with new vesting rights applications.
It's okay.
Everyone likes those so much.
There's not that many Res 4s out there.
There's not. I agree.
And 3.6 is not that huge difference. I would like to make an amendment to the motion that we stick with everything that Mr. Campbell's offered, with the exception of Res 3 staying at 11,000 square feet.
What do you want right now, Bob?
10.5. But reducing the density.
I all this way.
We have a motion, addendum to the motion. Amend it to 11,000 square feet for Res 3. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Please vote. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
Aye.
3-2. Motion addendum fails. Back to the original motion. As Mr. Tam stated, everybody understand the conditions?
And this is just to move to public hearing.
Public hearing. 10-5, 2.2 units.
Hold on. Is this going to Planning Commission or public hearing?
Planning Commission, public hearing, and then Board of Commissioners,
okay.
Public hearing.
Thank you.
1,250 square foot in Res 3. Res 4, 8,000 square foot lots, 3.6 units per acre. 1,250 square foot minimum.
Did you say 10,500?
Thank you, Michael.
Yeah.
Res
3. Res 3 is 10,500 square foot lots.
Right.
2.2 units per acre.
Right.
2,000 square foot minimum house size. Res 4 is 8,000 square foot acre lots, 3.6 units per acre. And a 1,250 square foot house, minimum. Correct? Okay.
Right.
I have a motion and a second for that.
The second.
Okay.
I'd like to amend the motion.
Yes, sir.
I'd like to amend the motion to get rid of Res 6.
Have a motion to get rid of Res 6. Air second?
Hold on just a second.
But we would, just to say, for procedurally, I think we'd have to say, make it a zoning district that can no longer be requested rather than get rid of it, because we have it out there on the map.
And there's right. Precedent for that. We've done that before.
Yeah,
it might be. So are we talking, then you're getting, I think it's for another day.
Just right back in.
Do you draw?
Nobody second.
Nobody second.
Yeah, I'll withdraw.
Okay. Back to the original motion, state Mr. Tam. Any other discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Carries 5-0.
Thank you.
14.
Mr. Chairman, we request.
Here we go. Mr. Perkins, go ahead.
Tom. We are requesting approval to allow the Water and Sewer Department to allow a temporary pump station to be placed on Chattahoochee Point Park. This is for the McClure property. The reason we believe that's a good idea, their original location is to put this pump station on their property about 1,200 feet further up north, and to tie into our future gravity sewer line, which we have planned with the Shake Rack facility, to just be an additional sewer line that has to be run through the Chattahoochee Point Park. This would be planned to be temporary. You've got some conceptual drawings in your package. The location that they are requesting is a place where we had planned possibly to put a pump station of our own. The smaller drawing shows the landscaping that would be put around this to hide it. The exact location of the driveway would be worked out with the Parks Department. We expect this pump station would stay in for around 3 years. The development is paying for the construction cost. All we'd be doing is allowing them to place this on county property. Typically, when it's put in a development, it's deeded to the county, to the Water and Sewer Department. So we are in favor of this request.
It's a
It would be good to have it time-sensitive so they can proceed with their design drawings. They'll have to get with engineering and planning and everybody else.
So how temporary is the temporary pump station in Chattahoochee Point Park?
When the gravity line or permanent pump station that will pump the shake rag is installed, we'll connect by gravity from this to the other. I don't know.
For how long? If you had to guess.
Three to four years.
3 to 4 years from the time you break down or ground, or 3 to 4 years from the time the pump station opens?
Tim, 100%, you don't mean including operational costs, do you?
Operational costs, after it's turned over to us, it's our operational costs.
Are they going to put the bill for the whole
thing? They build it.
They build it. Install it.
Install it.
Is there any use to this at the 3, 4, 5 year mark for any other purpose?
No.
Any other questions? Hear a motion from the board?
Their location was up at the entrance. They were going to put it right at the entrance of the park, close to the playground. And to phase it out later and get rid of it, we have to run a gravity line on through the park in some manner to phase it out. So I don't know who's going to have to pay for that gravity line later, but I suspected it would be us. So it saves probably 1,000 feet of gravity line that we would have to pay for. Was the only real reason.
Right, so I'll make a motion that we approve a temporary pump station that's going to serve for 3 to 4 years at Chattahoochee Point.
Time sensitive.
Second. Did you know Chattahoochee Point spell wrong?
Oh my goodness.
They made correct the spelling on that.
Yeah.
Have a motion and a second for the temporary pump for approval. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Passes 4-0.
Aye. I'm going to put a D on the end of parts.
Item 15,
we're going to
do this again today?
Mr. Chairman, we are not going to do this today. I do want to talk to you about it very quickly. You all had sent me off some time ago to figure out a solution with respect to No Longer Bound. They are a nonprofit. They do a lot of good work in the county. They basically have a men's, I think it's not a ministry as much as it is a drug rehab program. But they need to buy some sewer. And the direction you were given to me was to try and figure out a way to help them buy their sewer, but because of their financial situation, they need to pay us over time. They need to buy around 6,500 gallons of sewer at a price of around $97,500. They want to pay us over 10 years. That means a promissory note, and that means interest. The interest waiver, which is really what's gotten me all caught up in this as far as how I worked that out, was trying to derive value from what No Longer Bound provides to the county as equivalent of the interest they would otherwise pay us, right, for the cost of effectively financing their sewer payment over 10 years. They do provide, and I believe this, they do provide placements in their drug rehabilitation, both for the court system and for the sheriff. But at this point, neither the court or the sheriff really want to get into the weeds of documenting that. And I understand why. There are issues about whether or not if we begin to sort of hold them out as the county's preferred drug rehabilitation provider, does that put them in some sort of an advantage with respect to perhaps, you might argue, their competition, as it were. So right now, I don't have an answer for you. I'm still working on it, and I will try and bring something back to you. I did want to give you an update, though. So, Mr. Chairman, that's where we are, and I will do everything within my power to have this worked out by the next work session.
As long as our attorney fees don't equal the sewer tap, we'll be all right.
Wow. You know, that was really tough.
Oh, God. It's been a little over 2 months since you've gotten one of those comments. Yeah, because somebody's right here.
We have to straighten that out. Item 16, the appointment of new South Park Rec District Court.
Yes, I would like to make a motion to reappoint Gary Kiefer to the Forsyth County Park and Recreation Board.
Second. Have a motion and second to reappoint Gary Kiefer. All in favor, say aye. Aye. Any opposed?
Yeah,
chicken deck.
Item 17 has been deleted, removed. Item 18, presentation regarding drug paraphernalia.
It'll take a second.
And we need to know this with all the staff.
Show you that I can, in fact, do a PowerPoint.
Pretty excited about this.
All right, members of the board, this is something I wanted to walk you all through very briefly. You may recall some time ago the Board of Commissioners adopted an ordinance to address what we considered basically synthetic marijuana or synthetic cannabinoids, which is a big an issue right now among juveniles and our youth. You may recall an individual came and kind of spoke about the impact of K2 and Spice on one of his, maybe a brother or a sibling. And of course, you don't have to look hard for paper to find out that there's a lot of issues with this drug going on. So the Board of Commissioners adopted an ordinance that was effectively trying to address this drug, but otherwise not offend those legal positions or lawful positions that say we as a county cannot make something illegal that is already made illegal by state law, right? So we adopted an ordinance that basically said we are making illegal or synthetic marijuana illegal only to the extent it's not otherwise a substance that is controlled by the state. Okay, understand, a very narrow donut hole we were trying to run through. And the rationale we debated was the chemists are pretty good at sort of changing the chemical composition of this drug to stay ahead of our laws. So we basically said, whatever the state of Georgia says is illegal, we're not touching it. But if it's a synthetic marijuana product and the state of Georgia's not addressed it yet, it's illegal from our perspective. So that's what we did. It was done pursuant to our normal ordinance prohibition. So any person violating this ordinance will be fined up to $1,000 per day and 60 days in jail. And each offense would in fact be a separate penalty. Now you may say, well, Ken, has there ever been, have we ever tried to invoke this ordinance against anyone? Yes, we have. We had our first prosecution on December 12th of 2012. The sheriff's office conducted a synthetic marijuana buy at the Blank Food Mart located in Cumming, Georgia. I left off the address and the name of the food mart. The informant asked the clerk if he had anything. Apparently, within the context of that conversation, they knew what that meant. The clerk said $30 and produced a package from his pocket and completed the transaction. The informant purchased a package of what's called Supernova. The Supernova was sent, and this is where you see the actual effect of your ordinance. Okay, this was done under a county code. We had to send, because it's all based on the chemical composition, we had to send it to the GBI crime lab to have it chemically tested. So it was sent to the GBI for testing. The test results came back and showed the substance was not a DEA scheduled substance, but was listed on a Schedule 1 substance by the Georgia State Board of Pharmacy. Remember last year, in the wake of all the issues about synthetic drugs, K2 and Spice, the Georgia Department of Pharmacologists basically adopted this emergency declaration of these additional synthetic compounds that were also covered? Well, this substance, this Supernova, was in fact one of those. And here's the actual email from the FBI, the GBI. I'm going to skip that part and go here. The drug that you all confiscated was called XLR-11, which is one of the five compounds declared illegal by the Board of Pharmacy. Technically speaking, then, it would not fit into an unregulated marijuana substitute. Remember, that's what we regulated. It was anything that's not regulated.
I thought it was not regulated by the state.
It's regulated pursuant to that Board of Pharmacy's emergency order, and our ordinance specifically called that out too, because that was an enactment by the state for which we would be precluded. So I'll say all that to say we're trying, but we missed on this one because it was not one of the things that fell within our ordinance. You can see though, this is for real. I mean, you go to a clerk of this convenience store or whichever.
So they didn't even get in trouble?
It wasn't prosecuted under our ordinance. That's all I'm willing to share with you right now, because it couldn't come under our ordinance. I can't tell you whether they're going to have to go after them under the state law.
But there's nothing wrong with our ordinance. It just wasn't on the
website. Oh, no, there's nothing wrong with our ordinance at all. I'm just showing you an example.
That it really does.
Yeah, that's all I'm trying to show you is an example. So basically, the next request I got from the board was to look at the actual, I guess you'd say, the delivery systems, which is how some of these drugs are in fact administered to, you know, quite frankly, the kids and the citizens of the county. These are just some photographs where these sorts of things, and again, you know, this is not attempting to be an indictment of all of these. I suppose there are legal uses you can make of these, but the reality is, I think the way I heard it described to me, there's a lot of cross-contamination, meaning that for every one of these that may be used for some sort of legal administering of a drug, there's a lot of potentially illegal uses of the drug. And you'll notice if you see the white sign on the left photograph in the upper right-hand corner next to all those pipes, it says tobacco use only. Well, of course it does, because what else do you say, right? So in any event, that's sort of what we were tasked to look at next. So we looked at the possible avenues of dealing with those sort of drug administration techniques. First of all, could we make a law making the sale of drug paraphernalia illegal? Well, guess what? There's already a law making the selling of drug paraphernalia legal. That's the reason for that sign up in the upper left-hand corner of that photo. How about a law making the selling of tobacco paraphernalia to minors illegal? The city of Kennesaw method, and we'll talk about that in a second. A law requiring the sellers of tobacco to be licensed and permitted, and finally a law requiring that tobacco paraphernalia be hidden from public view. This is the law. The law is that the county cannot, I mean, I'm not going to take you through a treatise on the law, but the takeaway is the county cannot make illegal something the state already makes illegal. Okay, so armed with that information, let's look through the regulatory process. Number one, with respect, I've already mentioned drug paraphernalia is already illegal. Okay. With respect to tobacco-related paraphernalia or objects, in other words, those devices for the ingestion or administration of tobacco products, the sale of such products or objects to minors is already prohibited by state law. There's not only a Georgia code section, but there's also an administrative code section that says, and this is an interesting definition, the term tobacco-related project objects is defined as any papers, wrappers, or other products, devices, or substances which are used for the purpose of making cigarettes or tobacco in any form whatsoever. And you may think, well, does that cover sort of drug administration, sort of like these the hookahs or the bombs? Does that cover those sorts of devices? Well, we called the State Department of Revenue, and they said that tobacco-related objects includes bongs and pipes. So the selling of those items to minors is already prohibited under law. With respect to regulatory fees, businesses that sell tobacco-related objects are licensed by the state. Guess what that means? That means that we can't. We can't approach it that way from the standpoint of a regulatory fee. So not only do they have to pay a fee, but they're already licensed by the state as well. So they've got us on a license and they've got us on a fee. So here's an approach.
Well, we can certainly go in and make sure they're with the state and they're with the state license.
They have their licenses to confirm they are in fact appropriately licensed. But here's the thing I want you all to think about. What about, and this is just some language from other jurisdictions, not in Georgia. You'll be a little bit on the cutting edge on this one with respect to trying to address this issue. But what about the notion of making those sorts of products be kept from public view? In other words, we can't stop you from selling them, their licenses, they're permitted with the state, but you're not going to be able to display them out in the public. Now,
which is why it was in the guy's pocket.
Here's the issue. Well, this would be the actual... This would be the actual device to inhale the substance through. Now, if we go blindly down this path and start saying that anything that basically is a cigarette or a cigar or a smoking implement has to be hidden from public view, let me tell you what we're going to run into. We're going to run into cigar shops crying foul. we're going to run into even places like maybe Walmart or Target may sell pipes. I mean, so perfectly legitimate, reasonable, you know, decent providers of merchandise may not like that. So what we talked about in my office was perhaps we try to make a distinction between those sorts of implements. We all know what those are, basically rolled paper, some sort of a paper product, versus those. Now, if we do that, if we tried to carve that sort of a distinction in our law, we would run, and basically what we'd be saying is you got to keep this stuff such that you can't see it behind perhaps a blocked, opaque screen of some kind or what have you. Now, if we do that, but otherwise allow you to freely market cigars and pipes and cigarettes in public view, we could draw a challenge where someone's saying, you know, look, you're making a line in the sand that's arbitrary and capricious. But I got to tell you, I think we had a pretty good argument on that. I mean, I think people are using these sorts of devices in a way that people aren't using a traditional rolled cigarette or a traditional pipe or a traditional cigar. If we do that route and have a public hearing, I would probably want to invite some law enforcement. I'd want to create a record in your hearing to basically say what I'm just saying. In other words, we want to have a record of law enforcement saying these things are a problem. A typical smoking implement is not. All right, but to the extent you want to try and regulate smoking devices, drug, tobacco-related paraphernalia, that's the best I got for you. It is regulated. We can only, again, we have limited room to navigate. But if you want me to bring you back some language, I will.
What if you did only allow it to be sold in places that sold at least 50% cigars?
Walmart.
Yeah, Walmart does sell cigars.
Yeah, but then you're kind of taking it out of the head shop business and you put it in the cigar shop.
Yeah, but what about?
I think my
The grocery store though sells cigars, but I'm sure, and cigarettes, but I'm sure they're not 50%.
I know. But they don't sell this stuff.
No, they don't sell this stuff either.
I'm saying you can only sell this stuff if you sell.
The problem is I've got
50%.
Oh. I suspect I've got merchants, though, that are in fact licensed to sell this stuff, and we will basically be defeating their license by saying you can't sell it anymore.
So what is their license called?
Yeah, license by whom?
Well, the state.
Go back.
Yeah.
So they
sell it back.
And we don't know that they're licensed. I think you just have it, and they've never gotten a license. So.
Yeah, you have to have a license to sell tobacco products or tobacco-related objects, which I think that I mentioned in the Department of Revenue defines this as tobacco-related objects. So I think their argument would be to us, we're licensed and permitted and have a fee with the state to sell these devices. I'm sure roped within that would be traditional cigars and cigarettes. You probably see them behind the counters and you have to get them. But they would say, you know, I have every right to sell that by Department of Revenue rule. We would be saying, sure, you have every right to sell it, but you don't have the right to display it. You're gonna have to put it behind something. No, it's fine, please.
Much as I would like to, I'm finding these distinctions
impossible to make at this point. Well, maybe it's legal
to decide. It's challenging, but I will tell you this. Developing the K2 spice stuff was challenging as well. I mean, because we're trying to act in an area where there are presumptively criminal laws in place.
Yeah, but nobody can go and look at the stuff and say this is or is not on that scheduled list. It has to be analyzed.
Correct.
Okay. You can walk in, but a person, you know, I'm not trying to make their argument for them, is a meerschaum pipe something that shouldn't be displayed?
And that's where best I could do was talking about my yes. I mean, you're right. I think that's where we'd have to have proof, literally at our hearing, from law enforcement saying there's a lot of cross-contamination. These devices are used for both legitimate and illegitimate purposes.
So you can still buy them, but let's put them under the eyes of the children.
Well, but
and the general public.
But he's saying
we won't ask for it.
That's difficult to do because tobacco products are allowed.
They are. We would be drawing a distinction between traditional smoking devices like a cigar, pipe, or cigarette versus what I would say are these more non-traditional devices and bongs and hookahs and things like that. And could we draw a challenge based upon that? We could.
Yeah. The other absurdity is, you know, we're permitting stuff to be used, which is declared formally by the Attorney General of the United States to kill you. but preventing people from doing stuff that might kill you.
Can we issue an additional license for the bombs and such that you're looking at for an additional fee? And under that additional license, just put a price tag on they wouldn't want to pay? Just wait.
Add an additional regulatory fee to it over and above what the state provides?
To the point they find it's not within their business plan. If they want to still do it, fine. They have to raise the price of the product to accommodate their additional costs, like everybody does with anything.
You going to do that in cigarette tax? Cigarettes?
Hey, if you like that in your local stores, good. Tell your constituents that you're okay with that right there. Not general stuff, that.
Well, I'm not saying that you have to go in that store. You don't have to go in there.
There's a lot of people walk in there, and they've got their children with them and such, and they didn't know that was in there before they walked in the door.
I don't know.
Pornography magazines are covered. They're not in plain view. There's a reason for that. Same thing I'm trying to accomplish with this.
You know, and I've seen that, and Commissioner. I don't know whether that's by simple. That's a business decision. Those businesses have made based upon customer complaints, or I don't know. I've certainly seen what you're talking about.
Would we be better off to go through our state legislators and try to get them to enact state laws that would require them?
They've got the same problem.
Well, didn't they try to enact some new laws this year with K2 and stuff?
Well, that's sort of been an in-progress thing, yeah, just because the chemical compositions keep changing. The state delegation would have an easier job of it than us because they're not bound by the preemption doctrines we're bound by.
That's why I think.
But on the other hand, because it would be statewide, you could expect they're going to have a lot more difficulty getting a bill like that. I mean, I can see a lot of interest groups coming out that says, look, you know, these are perfectly legitimate and reasonable.
That's why I ask, could we have an additional license that to get for certain specific items have to pay an additional licensing fee that they may find it's worth or not worth doing it anymore in their stores?
Picked off more right those stores.
Can you possibly make law that for all tobacco and tobacco-related products that are sold, you must keep a list of the purchaser?
No, we can't do that.
I would have to see, again, it's going to depend upon the extent to which the state has spoken. I have not addressed that issue, and as far as my research, so it's going to depend. I mean, here's the bottom line. The farther we get into the business activities, the more pushback we're going to get to the extent they say that state law speaks to this, and therefore you can't. But I'd be willing to look at that issue. I'd be willing to look at any woman to, but I could look at that issue, and I could look at your additional.
State charges a licensing fee to the revenue for beer, wine, alcohol type sales.
Agreed.
We additionally add one to it as well. All jurisdictions do.
That's true.
I'm just saying, can you do the same with this?
That's true. And Commissioner Levant makes a great point. You know, obviously the state charges alcohol fees, and we do as well, but remember the state law specifically says counties can speak to this issue as well. And I'm not saying that necessarily ends the debate. There can be expressed and implied grants of that authority. So I can look at that as well and see if there's a supplemental fee that we can charge, if that's what the board wants me to do.
Can we bring it back one more time? Just look at it one more time before making a hard decision.
Can you bring those points back to us, Kim?
I can. I will look at Commissioner Boff and Commissioner Levant's supplements.
Any other things we're getting? Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Item 19, County Attorney, your county. Yep. Sam Lovitz, affair.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, does everybody have the document that I handed out to you called a notification and consent to return of compensation? Mm-hmm. I got it?
Mm-hmm.
All right, let me tell you what the issue was, and let me tell you why this is in front of you. The new coroner, I believe, had previously lined up her deputy coroners. And I got a call some time ago that apparently one of the deputy coroners that was lined up to serve had gotten a job
apparently a job they very much wanted, maybe in academia or something along those lines, and basically was not going to be the deputy coroner anymore. And so the coroner came and said, look, you know, I've got this other individual that I think is qualified to be the deputy coroner, Stan Rutledge. Okay, and once I need, I'd like to make him a deputy coroner for the county, all right? And that, of course, is the coroner's discretion, right, to pick her deputy coroners, that's fine. But the question that was asked of me was, is that a conflict of interest? And so I looked at the issue quite a bit. And here's, and we all know, right, Stan Rutledge is a principal of the company, what, Advanced Ambulance, which is the county's ambulance provider. So the issue was, is there a potential conflict of interest? And the resolution I came down in was that there could be a potential conflict of interest for this reason. I want y'all to hear this, and maybe I'm, you know, out there on how many angels can dance on the head of a pin, but nonetheless, I thought it was a concern. And the concern was, on accident scenes, when someone goes to the scene of either an accident or, in fact, even an injury or a potential death, those individuals typically are the folks on the first responders that call in the need for a coroner, right? Because if an individual is at the scene and believed to be deceased, that individual, they have to call that in, and that triggers what? That triggers the intervention of the coroner, right? That's who then comes and attends to the body. Well, if it was just the, if it was Mr. Rutledge as the coroner, that wouldn't be a particular concern to me. But the deputy coroner gets a per call fee for every time they make a run to go and assess basically the body, right? So my concern was, you would have a member of your corporation who would be on site making the call that might in fact trigger you to come out and therefore generate a per trip fee. Everybody understand my concern? All right, so that was the concern. And you know, do I believe that there will be a lot of ginned up calls for the coroner to trigger these fees? No, but is it enough of a concern where I felt it needed to be raised? I did. So I raised it. I said, look, you know, my concern, Madam Coroner, is that you'll have Advanced Ambulance on the scene making these calls. The calls could trigger the deputy coroner. Your deputy coroner would then generate a fee, a per diem, not a per diem, that's the wrong word, a per trip fee, and that could be a problem. That was then communicated to Mr. Rutledge. Mr. Rutledge says, I will waive my compensation. Well, from my perspective, if you waive your compensation, that addresses the issue, because now there's no possibility of financial remuneration based upon that trip. But now I got to get the waiver right, all right? And the issue that I'm bringing to you is, you can't just waive your compensation. The compensation belongs to the office. It's perfected by state law. So the compensation does, in fact, have to be paid, and it will automatically then go back to the county. Mr. Rutledge has agreed to that. There's more. Not only does the compensation have to be paid and immediately go back to the county, he will be taxed for it. It is still compensation. So that's right. So I have drafted a notification and consent to return of compensation that Mr. Rutledge has already seen, and he has agreed to sign. And it basically says that for his term in office, he will waive his compensation. He will have the, so in other words, basically our personnel or our folks will issue a check. The check will then immediately be deposited back to the county. It will go toward his taxes. And he will have to acknowledge various things, including that there's no FLSA, Fair Labor Standards Act liability associated with this. He's acknowledging that. He's acknowledging all the right things I'm comfortable with. But bottom line is, to be deputy coroner for Mr. Rutledge will actually cost him money, because it will involve taxation. It will involve taxation for income that he will not realize. Everybody understand what's happening here? So the income will get paid, but it'll get paid right back to the county.
He's going to pay us to be deputy coroner.
Yes.
We beat him up on a little bit of gas.
He's going to pay the feds so he can.
Only for some cash.
Only for some cash. Well, beat him up bad over a little bit of gas.
So,
Imagine if we had beat that by heart. We're free all.
Can we maybe try that?
So what do you need, Counselor?
Well, Mr. Rutledge has already agreed to this. He has not signed it yet, but he will. The coroner will also sign this, and I want the Board of Commissioners to ratify this. And there's the only reason I want you to ratify it is I wanted to say all of this at this in an open session. I wanted to tell you what's going on so no one's confused. And I want the Board of Commissioners to ratify it simply so that it's on the record. This is not time sensitive.
I hope it's the last item to get served.
If the Board of Commissioners ratifies it, I'll have it all signed and it'll go on a consent agenda at your next meeting.
Do we have to build a statue to this guy or anything?
No.
Do I hear a motion from the board to ratify this agenda?
Second.
Have a motion and a second to ratify the agenda as presented to the council. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? 5-0. Thank you, council. Council, is there a need for executive session to discuss litigation, land acquisition, and personnel?
There is, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Is there a motion to recess to work session?
So moved.
Second. Have a motion second to recess to work session. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
We'll take a 6-minute break. We can meet at 5 o'clock.
Get together. Yeah, I got a copy. I have to figure out when it's coming back in and what we're recording.